The Crystal Stopper by Maurice Leblanc. Chapter 1. The Arrests. The two boats fastened to the little pier that jutted out from the garden lay rocking in its shadow. Here and there, lighted windows showed through the thick mist on the margins of the lake. The Enghien casino opposite blazed with light, though it was late in the season, the end of September. A few stars appeared through the clouds. A light breeze ruffled the surface of the water. Arsène Lupin left the summer-house where he was smoking a cigar, and bending forward at the end of the pier. "Growler?" he asked. "Masher? Are you there?" A man rose from each of the boats, and one of them answered, "Yes, Governor." "Get ready. I hear the car coming with Gilbert and Vaucheray." He crossed the garden, walked round a house in process of construction, the scaffolding of which loomed overhead, and cautiously opened the door on the Avenue de Ceinture. He was not mistaken. A bright light flashed round the bend, and a large, open motor-car drew up, whence sprang two men in greatcoats, with the collars turned up, and caps. It was Gilbert and Vaucheray. Gilbert, a young fellow of 20 or 22, with an attractive cast of features and a supple and sinewy frame. Vaucheray, older, shorter, with grizzled hair and a pale, sickly face. "Well," asked Lupin, "did you see him, the deputy?" "Yes, Governor," said Gilbert. "We saw him take the 7:40 tram for Paris, as we knew he would."
"Then we are free to act?"
"Absolutely. The Villa Marie-Thérèse is ours to do as we please with." The chauffeur had kept his seat. Lupin gave him his orders. "Don't wait here. It might attract attention. Be back at 9:30 exactly, in time to load the car, unless the whole business falls through."
"Why should it fall through?" observed Gilbert.
The motor drove away, and Lupin, taking the road to the lake with his two companions, replied, "Why? Because I didn't prepare the plan, and when I don't do a thing myself, I am only half confident."
"Nonsense, Governor. I've been working with you for 3 years now. I'm beginning to know the ropes."
"Yes, my lad, you're beginning," said Lupin, "and that's just why I'm afraid of blunders. Here, get in with me. And you, Vaucheray, take the other boat. That's it. And now push off, boys, and make as little noise as you can."
Growler and Masher, the two oarsmen, made straight for the opposite bank, a little to the left of the casino.
They met a boat containing a couple locked in each other's arms, floating at random, and another in which a number of people were singing at the top of their voices, and that was all.
Lupin shifted closer to his companion and said, under his breath, "Tell me, Gilbert, did you think of this job, or was it Vaucheray's idea?"
"Upon my word, I couldn't tell you. We've both of us been discussing it for weeks."
"The thing is, I don't trust Vaucheray. He's a low ruffian when one gets to know him. I can't make out why I don't get rid of him."
"Oh, Governor!"
"Yes, yes, I mean what I say. He's a dangerous fellow, to say nothing of the fact that he has some rather serious peccadilloes on his conscience."
He sat silent for a moment and continued,
"So you're quite sure that you saw Daubrecq, the deputy?"
"Saw him with my own eyes, Governor."
"And you know that he has an appointment in Paris?"
"He's going to the theatre."
"Very well, but his servants have remained behind at the Enghien Villa.
The cook has been sent away. As for the valet, Léonard, who is Daubrecq's confidential man, he'll wait for his master in Paris. They can't get back from town before 1 o'clock in the morning."
But what?"
"We must reckon with a possible freak of fancy on Daubrecq's part, a change of mind, an unexpected return, and so arrange to have everything finished and done within an hour."
"And when did you get these details?"
"This morning. Vaucheray and I at once thought that it was a favourable moment. I selected the garden of the unfinished house which we have just left as the best place to start from, for the house is not watched at night. I sent for two mates to row the boats, and I telephoned to you. That's the whole story."
"Have you the keys?"
"The keys of the front door."
"Is that the villa which I see from here, standing in its own grounds?"
"Yes, the Villa Marie-Thérèse. And as the two others, with the gardens touching it on either side, have been unoccupied since this day week, we shall be able to remove what we please at our leisure. And I swear to you, Governor, it's well worth while."
"The job's much too simple," mumbled Lupin. "No charm about it."
They landed in a little creek whence rose a few stone steps, under cover of a mouldering roof. Lupin reflected that shipping the furniture would be easy work, but suddenly he said,
"There are people at the villa. Look, a light." "It's a gas jet, Governor. The light's not moving." The growler stayed by the boats, with instructions to keep watch, while the masher, the other rower, went to the gate on the Avenue de Ceinture, and Dupin and his two companions crept in the shadow to the foot of the steps. Gilbert went up first. Groping in the dark, he inserted first the big door-key and then the latch-key. Both turned easily in their locks. The door opened, and the three men walked in. A gas jet was flaring in the hall. "You see, Governor," said Gilbert. "Yes, yes," said Lupin in a low voice. "But it seems to me that the light which I saw shining did not come from here."
"Where did it come from, then?"
"I can't say. Is this the drawing-room?"
"No," replied Gilbert, who was not afraid to speak pretty loudly. "No, by way of precaution, he keeps everything on the first floor, in his bedroom, and in the two rooms on either side of it."
"And where is the staircase?"
"On the right, behind the curtain."
Lupin moved to the curtain and was drawing the hanging aside when, suddenly, at four steps on the left, a door opened and a head appeared, a pallid man's head with terrified eyes.
"Help! Murder!"
shouted the man, and he rushed back into the room.
"It's Léonard, the valet!" cried Gilbert.
"If he makes a fuss, I'll out him," growled Vaucheray.
"You'll jolly well do nothing of the sort, do you hear, Vaucheray?"
said Lupin peremptorily. And he darted off in pursuit of the servant. He first went through a dining-room, where he saw a lamp still lit, with plates and a bottle around it, and he found Léonard at the further end of a pantry, making vain efforts to open the window.
"Don't move, Sporty. No kid."
"Ah, the brute!"
He had thrown himself flat on the floor on seeing Léonard raise his arm at him. Three shots were fired in the dusk of the pantry, and then the valet came tumbling to the ground, seized by the legs by Lupin, who snatched his weapon from him and gripped him by the throat.
"Get out, you dirty brute!" he growled.
"He very nearly did for me. Here, Vaucheray, secure this gentleman."
He threw the light of his pocket-lantern on the servant's face and chuckled.
"He's not a pretty gentleman, either. You can't have a very clear conscience, Léonard. Besides, to play flunky to Daubrecq, the deputy. Have you finished, Vaucheray? I don't want to hang about here forever."
"There's no danger, Governor," said Gilbert.
"Oh, really? So you think that shots can't be heard?"
"Quite impossible."
"No matter. We must look sharp. Vaucheray, take the lamp and let's go upstairs."
He took Gilbert by the arm, and, as he dragged him to the first floor,
"You ass," he said. "Is that the way you make inquiries? Wasn't I right to have my doubts?"
"Look here, Governor, I couldn't know that he could change his mind and come back to dinner."
"One's got to know everything when one has the honour of breaking into people's houses. You numbskull! I'll remember you in Vaucheray. A nice pair of gossoons!"
The sight of the furniture on the first floor pacified Lupin, and he started on his inventory with the satisfied air of a collector who has looked in to treat himself to a few works of art.
"By jingo! There's not much of it, but what there is pucker. There's nothing the matter with this representative of the people in the question of taste. Four Aubusson chairs, a bureau signed Percier Fontaine for a wager, two inlays by Gouttière, a genuine Fragonard, and a sham Natier which any American millionaire will swallow for the asking. In short, a fortune. And there are curmudgeons who pretend that there's nothing but faked stuff left. Dash it all, why don't they do as I do? They should look about."
Gilbert and Vaucheray, following Lupin's orders and instructions, at once proceeded methodically to remove the bulkier pieces. The first boat was filled in half an hour, and it was decided that the growler and the masher should go on ahead and begin to load the motor-car. Lupin went to see them start. On returning to the house, it struck him, as he passed through the hall, that he heard a voice in the pantry. He went there and found Léonard lying flat on his stomach, quite alone, with his hands tied behind his back.
"So it's you growling, my confidential flunky. Don't get excited. It's almost finished. Only if you make too much noise, you'll oblige us to take severer measures. Do you like pears? We might give you one, you know. A choke pear."
As he went upstairs, he again heard the same sound, and stopping to listen, he caught these words, uttered in a hoarse, groaning voice, which came, beyond a doubt, from the pantry.
"Help! Murder! Help! I shall be killed! Inform the commissary!"
"The fellow's clean off his chump," muttered Lupin. "By Jove, to disturb the police at 9 o'clock in the evening! There's a notion for you!"
He set to work again. It took longer than he expected, for they discovered in the cupboards all sorts of valuable knick-knacks, which it would have been very wrong to disdain and, on the other hand, Vaucheray and Gilbert were going about their investigations with signs of laboured concentration that nonplussed him. At long last he lost his patience.
"That will do," he said. "We're not going to spoil the whole job and keep the motor waiting for the sake of the few odd bits that remain. I'm taking the boat."
They were now by the waterside, and Dupin went down the steps. Gilbert held him back.
"I say, Governor, we want one more look round 5 minutes, no longer."
"But what for, dash it all?"
"Well, it's like this. We were told of an old reliquary, something stunning."
"Well?"
"We can't lay our hands on it. And I was thinking, there's a cupboard with a big lock to it in the pantry. You see, we can't very well."
He was already on his way to the villa. Vaucheray ran back, too.
"I'll give you 10 minutes, not a second longer," cried Lupin. "In 10 minutes, I'm off."
But the 10 minutes passed, and he was still waiting. He looked at his watch.
"A 9:15, he said to himself. "This is madness."
And he also remembered that Gilbert and Vaucheray had behaved rather queerly throughout the removal of the things, keeping close together and apparently watching each other.
What could be happening?
Lupin mechanically returned to the house, urged by a feeling of anxiety which he was unable to explain, and at the same time he listened to a dull sound which rose in the distance from the direction of Enghien, and which seemed to be coming nearer. People strolling about, no doubt. He gave a sharp whistle and then went to the main gate, to take a glance down the avenue. But suddenly, as he was opening the gate, a shot rang out, followed by a yell of pain. He returned at a run, went round the house, leapt up the steps, and rushed to the dining-room.
"Blast it all! What are you doing there, you two?"
Gilbert and Vaucheray, locked in a furious embrace, were rolling on the floor, uttering cries of rage. Their clothes were dripping with blood. Lupin flew at them to separate them. But already Gilbert had got his adversary down, and was wrenching out of his hand something which Lupin had no time to see. And Vaucheray, who was losing blood through a wound in the shoulder, fainted.
"Who hurt him? You, Gilbert?"
asked Lupin furiously.
"No, Léonard." "Léonard? Well, he was tied up."
"He undid his fastenings and got hold of his revolver."
"The scoundrel! Where is he?"
Lupin took the lamp and went into the pantry. The manservant was lying on his back, with his arms outstretched, a dagger stuck in his throat and a livid face. A red stream trickled from his mouth.
"Ah!"
gasped Lupin, after examining him.
"He's dead!" "Do you think so? Do you think so?"
stammered Gilbert in a trembling voice.
"He's dead, I tell you."
"It was Vaucheray. It was Vaucheray who did it."
Pale with anger, Lupin caught hold of him.
"It was Vaucheray, was it? And you too, you blackguard, since you were there and didn't stop him. Blood! Blood! You know I won't have it. Well, it's a bad lookout for you, my fine fellows. You'll have to pay the damage, and you won't get off cheaply either. Mind the guillotine."
And shaking him violently, "What was it? Why did he kill him?"
"He wanted to go through his pockets and take the key of the cupboard from him. When he stooped over him, he saw that the man unloosed his arms. He got frightened, and he stabbed him."
"But the revolver shot?"
"It was Léonard. He had his revolver in his hand. He just had strength to take aim before he died."
"And the key of the cupboard?"
"Vaucheray took it."
"Did he open it? And did he find what he was after?"
"Yes."
"And you wanted to take the thing from him? What sort of thing was it? The reliquary?"
"No, it was too small for that."
"Then what was it? Answer me, will you?"
Lupin gathered from Gilbert's silence and the determined expression on his face that he would not obtain a reply. With a threatening gesture, "I'll make you talk, my man. Sure as my name's Lupin, you shall come out with it. But for the moment, we must see about decamping. Here, help me. We must get Vaucheray into the boat."
They had returned to the dining-room, and Gilbert was bending over the wounded man, when Lupin stopped him.
"Listen."
They exchanged one look of alarm. Someone was speaking in the pantry, a very low, strange, very distant voice. Nevertheless, as they at once made certain, there was no one in the room, no one except the dead man, whose dark outline lay stretched upon the floor. And the voice spake anew, by turns shrill, stifled, bleating, stammering, yelling, fearsome. It uttered indistinct words, broken syllables. Lupin felt the top of his head covering with perspiration. What was this incoherent voice, mysterious as a voice from beyond the grave? He had knelt down by the manservant's side. The voice was silent, and then began again.
"Give us a better light," he said to Gilbert.
He was trembling a little, shaken with a nervous dread which he was unable to master, for there was no doubt possible. When Gilbert had removed the shade from the lamp, Lupin realized that the voice issued from the corpse itself, without a movement of the lifeless mass, without a quiver of the bleeding mouth.
"Governor, I've got the shivers," stammered Gilbert.
Again the same voice, the same snuffling whisper. Suddenly Lupin burst out laughing, seized the corpse and pulled it aside.
"Exactly," he said, catching sight of an object made of polished metal. "Exactly, that's it. Well, upon my word, it took me long enough."
On the spot on the floor which he had uncovered lay the receiver of a telephone, the cord of which ran up to the apparatus fixed on the wall, at the usual height. Lupin put the receiver to his ear. The noise began again at once, but it was a mixed noise, made up of different calls, exclamations, confused cries, the noise produced by a number of persons questioning one another at the same time.
"Are you there? You won't answer. It's awful. They must have killed him. What is it? Keep up your courage. There's help on the way. Police. Soldiers."
"Dash it," said Lupin, dropping the receiver. The truth appeared to him in a terrifying vision. Quite at the beginning, while the things upstairs were being moved, Léonard, whose bonds were not securely fastened, had contrived to scramble to his feet, to unhook the receiver, probably with his teeth, to drop it and to appeal for assistance to the Enghien telephone exchange. And those were the words which Lupin had overheard, after the first boat started. "Help, murder, I shall be killed." And this was the reply of the exchange. The police were hurrying to the spot, and Lupin remembered the sounds which he had heard from the garden, 4 or 5 minutes earlier at most.
"The police! Take to your heels!" he shouted, darting across the dining-room.
"What about Vaucheray?" asked Gilbert.
"Sorry, can't be helped."
But Vaucheray, waking from his torpor, entreated him as he passed.
"Governor, you wouldn't leave me like this!"
Lupin stopped in spite of the danger, and was lifting the wounded man, with Gilbert's assistance, when a loud din arose outside.
"Too late," he said.
At that moment blows shook the hall door at the back of the house. He ran to the front steps. A number of men had already turned the corner of the house at a rush. He might have managed to keep ahead of them, with Gilbert, and reach the waterside, but what chance was there of embarking and escaping under the enemy's fire? He locked and bolted the door.
"We are surrounded and done for," spluttered Gilbert.
"Hold your tongue," said Lupin.
"But they've seen us, Governor. There, they're knocking."
"Hold your tongue," Lupin repeated. "Not a word, not a movement." He himself remained unperturbed, with an utterly calm face and the pensive attitude of one who has all the time that he needs to examine a delicate situation from every point of view. He had reached one of those minutes which he called the superior moments of existence, those which alone give a value and a price to life. On such occasions, however threatening the danger, he always began by counting to himself slowly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, until the beating of his heart became normal and regular. Then, and not till then, he reflected, but with what intensity, with what perspicacity, with what a profound intuition of possibilities. All the factors of the problem were present in his mind. He foresaw everything. He admitted everything, and he took his resolution in all logic and in all certainty. After 30 or 40 seconds, while the men outside were banging at the doors and picking the locks, he said to his companion, "Follow me." Returning to the dining-room, he softly opened the sash and drew the Venetian blinds of a window in the side wall. People were coming and going, rendering flight out of the question. Thereupon he began to shout with all his might, in a breathless voice,
"This way! Help! I've got them! This way!"
He pointed his revolver and fired 2 shots into the treetops. Then he went back to Vaucheray, bent over him and smeared his face and hands with the wounded man's blood. Lastly, turning upon Gilbert, he took him violently by the shoulders and threw him to the floor.
"What do you want, Governor? There's a nice thing to do."
"Let me do as I please," said Lupin, laying an imperative stress on every syllable. "I'll answer for everything. I'll answer for the two of you. Let me do as I like with you. I'll get you both out of prison. But I can only do that if I'm free." Excited cries rose through the open window.
"This way," he shouted. "I've got them. Help!" and quietly, in a whisper, "Just think for a moment. Have you anything to say to me? Something that can be of use to us?"
Gilbert was too much taken aback to understand Lupin's plan, and he struggled furiously. Vaucheray showed more intelligence. Moreover, he had given up all hope of escape because of his wound, and he snarled,
"Let the governor have his way, you ass! As long as he gets off, isn't that the great thing?"
Suddenly, Lupin remembered the article which Gilbert had put in his pocket, after capturing it from Vaucheray. He now tried to take it in his turn.
"No, not that. Not if I know it," growled Gilbert, managing to release himself.
Lupin floored him once more. But two men suddenly appeared at the window, and Gilbert yielded, and handing the thing to Lupin, who pocketed it without looking at it, whispered,
"Here you are, Governor. I'll explain. You can be sure that..."
He did not have time to finish. Two policemen, and others after them, and soldiers who entered through every door and window, came to Lupin's assistance. Gilbert was at once seized and firmly bound. Lupin withdrew.
"Oh, I'm glad you've come," he said. "The beggar's given me a lot of trouble. I wounded the other, but this one..."
The commissary of police asked him, hurriedly, "Have you seen the manservant? Have they killed him?"
"I don't know," he answered.
"You don't know?
Why, I came with you from Enghien on hearing of the murder. Only while you were going round the left of the house, I went round the right. There was a window open. I climbed up just as these two ruffians were about to jump down. I fired at this one," pointing to Vaucheray, "and seized hold of his pal."
How could he have been suspected? He was covered with blood. He had handed over the valet's murderers. Half a score of people had witnessed the end of the heroic combat which he had delivered. Besides, the uproar was too great for anyone to take the trouble to argue, or to waste time in entertaining doubts. In the height of the first confusion, the people of the neighbourhood invaded the villa. One and all lost their heads. They ran to every side, upstairs, downstairs, to the very cellar. They asked one another questions, yelled and shouted, and no one dreamt of checking Lupin's statements, which sounded so plausible. However, the discovery of the body in the pantry restored the commissary to a sense of his responsibility. He issued orders, had the house cleared, and placed policemen at the gate to prevent anyone from passing in or out. Then, without further delay, he examined the spot and began his inquiry. Vaucheray gave his name. Gilbert refused to give his, on the plea that he would only speak in the presence of a lawyer. But when he was accused of the murder, he informed against Vaucheray, who defended himself by denouncing the other. And the two of them vociferated at the same time, with the evident wish to monopolize the commissary's attention. When the commissary turned to Lupin to request his evidence, he perceived that the stranger was no longer there. Without the least suspicion, he said to one of the policemen, "Go and tell that gentleman that I should like to ask him a few questions." They looked about for the gentleman. Someone had seen him standing on the steps, lighting a cigarette. The next news was that he had given cigarettes to a group of soldiers and strolled towards the lake, saying that they were to call him if he was wanted. They called him. No one replied. But a soldier came running up. The gentleman had just got into a boat and was rowing away for all he was worth. The commissary looked at Gilbert and realized that he had been tricked.
"Stop him!" he shouted. "Fire on him! He's an accomplice!"
He himself rushed out, followed by two policemen, while the others remained with the prisoners. On reaching the bank, he saw the gentleman, 100 yards away, taking off his hat to him in the dusk. One of the policemen discharged his revolver without thinking. The wind carried the sound of words across the water. The gentleman was singing as he rowed.
"Go, little bark, float in the dark."
But the commissary saw a skiff fastened to the landing stage of the adjoining property. He scrambled over the hedge separating the two gardens, and after ordering the soldiers to watch the banks of the lake and to seize the fugitive if he tried to put ashore, the commissary and two of his men pulled off in pursuit of Lupin. It was not a difficult matter, for they were able to follow his movements by the intermittent light of the moon and to see that he was trying to cross the lakes while bearing toward the right, that is to say, toward the village of Saint-Gratien. Moreover, the commissary soon perceived that, with the aid of his men, and thanks perhaps to the comparative lightness of his craft, he was rapidly gaining on the other. In 10 minutes he had decreased the interval between them by one half.
"That's it," he cried. "We shan't even need the soldiers to keep him from landing. I very much want to make the fellow's acquaintance. He's a cool hand, and no mistake."
The funny thing was that the distance was now diminishing at an abnormal rate, as though the fugitive had lost heart at realizing the futility of the struggle. The policemen redoubled their efforts. The boat shot across the water with the swiftness of a swallow. Another 100 yards at most, and they would reach the man.
"Halt!" cried the commissary.
The enemy, whose huddled shape they could make out in the boat, no longer moved. The sculls drifted with the stream, and this absence of all motion had something alarming about it. A ruffian of that stamp might easily lie in wait for his aggressors, sell his life dearly, and even shoot them dead before they had a chance of attacking him.
"Surrender!" shouted the commissary.
The sky at that moment was dark. The three men lay flat at the bottom of their skiff, for they thought they perceived a threatening gesture. The boat, carried by its own impetus, was approaching the other. The commissary growled,
"We won't let ourselves be sniped. Let's fire at him. Are you ready?"
And he roared once more,
"Surrender! If not..."
No reply. The enemy did not budge.
"Surrender! Hands up!"
"You refuse? So much the worse for you. I'm counting. 1, 2... The policemen did not wait for the word of command. They fired, and at once, bending over their oars, gave the boat so powerful an impulse that it reached the goal in a few strokes. The commissary watched, revolver in hand, ready for the least movement. He raised his arm.
"If you stir, I'll blow out your brains."
But the enemy did not stir for a moment, and when the boat was bumped and the two men, letting go their oars, prepared for the formidable assault, the commissary understood the reason of this passive attitude. There was no one in the boat. The enemy had escaped by swimming, leaving in the hands of the victor a certain number of the stolen articles, which, heaped up and surmounted by a jacket and a bowler hat, might be taken at a pinch, in the semi-darkness, vaguely to represent the figure of a man. They struck matches and examined the enemy's cast clothes. There were no initials in the hat. The jacket contained neither papers nor pocketbook. Nevertheless, they made a discovery which was destined to give the case no little celebrity, and which had a terrible influence on the fate of Gilbert and Vaucheray. In one of the pockets was a visiting card which the fugitive had left behind, the card of Arsène Lupin. At almost the same moment, while the police, towing the captured skiff behind them, continued their empty search, and while the soldiers stood drawn up on the bank, straining their eyes to try and follow the fortunes of the naval combat, the aforesaid Arsène Lupin was quietly landing at the very spot which he had left 2 hours earlier. He was met there by his two other accomplices, the Growler and the Masher, flung them a few sentences by way of explanation, jumped in the motor-car among Daubrecq the deputy's armchairs and other valuables, wrapped himself in his furs, and drove, by deserted roads, to his repository at Neuilly, where he left the chauffeur. A taxicab brought him back to Paris and put him down by the church of Saint-Philippe-du-Roule, not far from which, in the rue de Matignon, he had a flat on the entresol floor, of which none of his gang, excepting Gilbert, knew, a flat with a private entrance. He was glad to take off his clothes and rub himself down, for in spite of his strong constitution he felt chilled to the bone. On retiring to bed, he emptied the contents of his pockets, as usual, on the mantelpiece. It was not till then that he noticed, near his pocketbook and his keys, the object which Gilbert had put into his hand at the last moment. He was very much surprised. It was a decanter stopper, a little crystal stopper, like those used for the bottles in a liqueur stand. And this crystal stopper had nothing particular about it. The most that Lupin observed was that the knob, with its many facets, was gilded right down to the indent. But to tell the truth, this detail did not seem to him of a nature to attract special notice. And it was this bit of glass to which Gilbert and Vaucheray attached such stubborn importance, he said to himself. It was for this that they killed the valet, fought each other, wasted their time, risked prison, trial, the scaffold. Too tired to linger further upon this matter, exciting though it appeared to him, he replaced the stopper on the chimney-piece and got into bed. He had bad dreams. Gilbert and Vaucheray were kneeling on the flags of their cells, wildly stretching out their hands to him and yelling with fright. "Help! Help!" they cried. But notwithstanding all his efforts, he was unable to move. He himself was fastened by invisible bonds. And trembling, obsessed by a monstrous vision, he watched the dismal preparations, the cutting of the condemned men's hair and shirt-collars, the squalid tragedy. "By Jove!" he said, when he woke after a series of nightmares. "There's a lot of bad omens. Fortunately, we don't err on the side of superstition. Otherwise..." And he added,
For that matter, we have a talisman which, to judge by Gilbert and Vaucheray's behaviour, should be enough, with Lupin's help, to frustrate bad luck and secure the triumph of the good cause. Let's have a look at that crystal stopper." He sprang out of bed to take the thing and examine it more closely. An exclamation escaped him. The crystal stopper had disappeared.
Chapter 2. 8 from 9 leaves 1. Notwithstanding my friendly relations with Lupin, and the many flattering proofs of his confidence which he has given me, there is one thing which I have never been quite able to fathom, and that is the organization of his gang. The existence of the gang is an undoubted fact. Certain adventures can be explained only by countless acts of devotion, invincible efforts of energy, and powerful cases of complicity, representing so many forces which all obey one mighty will. But how is this will exerted? Through what intermediaries, through what subordinates? That is what I do not know. Lupin keeps his secret, and the secrets which Lupin chooses to keep are, so to speak, impenetrable. The only supposition which I can allow myself to make is that this gang, which in my opinion is very limited in numbers, and therefore all the more formidable, is completed and extended indefinitely by the addition of independent units, provisional associates picked up in every class of society and in every country of the world, who are the executive agents of an authority with which, in many cases, they are not even acquainted. The companions, the initiates, the faithful adherents, men who play the leading parts under the direct command of Lupin, move to and fro between these secondary agents and the master. Gilbert and Vaucheray evidently belong to the main gang, and that is why the law showed itself so implacable in their regard. For the first time it held accomplices of Lupin in its clutches, declared, undisputed accomplices, and those accomplices had committed a murder. If the murder was premeditated, if the accusation of deliberate homicide could be supported by substantial proofs, it meant the scaffold. Now there was at the very least one self-evident proof, the cry for assistance which Léonard had sent over the telephone a few minutes before his death. "Help! Murder! I shall be killed!" The desperate appeal had been heard by two men, the operator on duty and one of his fellow clerks, who swore to it positively. And it was in consequence of this appeal that the commissary of police, who was at once informed, had proceeded to the Villa Marie-Thérèse, escorted by his men and a number of soldiers off duty. Lupin had a very clear notion of the danger from the first. The fierce struggle in which he had engaged against society was entering upon a new and terrible phase. His luck was turning. It was no longer a matter of attacking others, but of defending himself and saving the heads of his two companions. A little memorandum, which I have copied from one of the notebooks in which he often jots down a summary of the situations that perplex him, will show us the workings of his brain. One definite fact, to begin with, is that Gilbert and Vaucheray humbugged me. The Enghien expedition, undertaken ostensibly with the object of robbing the Villa Marie-Thérèse, had a secret purpose. This purpose obsessed their minds throughout the operations, and what they were looking for, under the furniture and in the cupboards, was one thing and one thing only, the crystal stopper. Therefore, if I want to see clear ahead, I must first of all know what this means. It is certain that, for some hidden reason, that mysterious piece of glass possesses an incalculable value in their eyes. And not only in theirs, for last night someone was bold enough and clever enough to enter my flat and steal the object in question from me. This theft of which he was the victim puzzled Lupin curiously. Two problems, both equally difficult of solution, presented themselves to his mind. First, who was the mysterious visitor? Gilbert, who enjoyed his entire confidence and acted as his private secretary, was the only one who knew of the retreat in the Rue Matignon. Now Gilbert was in prison. Was Lupin to suppose that Gilbert had betrayed him and put the police on his tracks? In that case, why were they content with taking the crystal stopper instead of arresting him, Lupin? But there was something much stranger still. Admitting that they had been able to force the doors of his flat, and this he was compelled to admit, though there was no mark to show it, how had they succeeded in entering the bedroom? He turned the key and pushed the bolt as he did every evening, in accordance with a habit from which he never departed. And nevertheless, the fact was undeniable, the crystal stopper had disappeared without the lock or the bolt having been touched. And although Lupin flattered himself that he had sharp ears, even when asleep, not a sound had waked him. He took no great pains to probe the mystery.
He knew those problems too well to hope that this one could be solved other than in the course of events. But feeling very much put out and exceedingly uneasy, he then and there locked up his entresol flat in the Rue Matignon and swore that he would never set foot in it again. And he applied himself forthwith to the question of corresponding with Vaucheray or Gilbert. Here a fresh disappointment awaited him. It was so clearly understood, both at the Santé prison and at the law courts, that all communication between Lupin and the prisoners must be absolutely prevented, that a multitude of minute precautions were ordered by the prefect of police and minutely observed by the lowest subordinates. Tried policemen, always the same men, watched Gilbert and Vaucheray day and night, and never let them out of their sight. Lupin, at this time, had not yet promoted himself to the crowning honour of his career, the post of chief of the detective service, and consequently was not able to take steps at the law courts to ensure the execution of his plans. After a fortnight of fruitless endeavours, he was obliged to bow. He did so with a raging heart and a growing sense of anxiety. The difficult part of a business, he often says, is not the finish, but the start. Where was he to start in the present circumstances? What road was he to follow? His thoughts recurred to Daubrecq, the deputy, the original owner of the crystal stopper, who probably knew its importance. On the other hand, how was Gilbert aware of the doings and mode of life of Daubrecq, the deputy? What means had he employed to keep him under observation? Who had told him of the place where Daubrecq spent the evening of that day? These were all interesting questions to solve. Daubrecq had moved to his winter quarters in Paris immediately after the burglary at the Villa Marie-Thérèse, and was now living in his own house, on the left-hand side of the little square Lamartine that opens out at the end of the Avenue Victor Hugo. First disguising himself as an old gentleman of private means, strolling about, cane in hand, Lupin spent his time in the neighbourhood, on the benches of the square and the avenue. He made a discovery on the first day. Two men, dressed as workmen, but behaving in a manner that left no doubt as to their aims, were watching the deputy's house. When Daubrecq went out, they set off in pursuit of him, and they were immediately behind him when he came home again. At night, as soon as the lights were out, they went away. Lupin shadowed them in his turn. They were detective officers. "Hello, hello," he said to himself. "This is hardly what I expected. So the Daubrecq bird is under suspicion." But on the fourth day, at nightfall, the two men were joined by six others, who conversed with them in the darkest part of the Square Lamartine. And among these new arrivals, Lupin was vastly astonished to recognize, by his figure and bearing, the famous Prasville, the erstwhile barrister, sportsman and explorer, now favourite at the Élysée, who for some mysterious reason had been pitchforked into the headquarters of police as secretary-general, with the reversion of the prefecture. And suddenly Lupin remembered. 2 years ago, Prasville and Daubrecq, the deputy, had had a personal encounter on the Place du Palais Bourbon. The incident made a great stir at the time. No one knew the cause of it. Prasville had sent his seconds to Daubrecq on the same day, but Daubrecq refused to fight. A little while later, Prasville was appointed secretary-general. "Very odd, very odd," said Lupin, who remained plunged in thought while continuing to observe Prasville's movements. At 7 o'clock, Prasville's group of men moved away a few yards, in the direction of the Avenue Henri Martin. The door of a small garden on the right of the house opened and Daubrecq appeared. The two detectives followed close behind him, and when he took the Rue Taitbout train, jumped on after him. Prasville at once walked across the square and rang the bell. The garden gate was between the house and the porter's lodge. The portress came and opened it. There was a brief conversation, after which Prasville and his companions were admitted. "A domiciliary visit," said Lupin. "Secret and illegal. By the strict rules of politeness, I ought to be invited. My presence is indispensable." Without the least hesitation, he went up to the house, the door of which had not been closed, and passing in front of the portress, who was casting her eyes outside, he asked, in the hurried tones of a person who is late for an appointment, "Have the gentlemen come?" "Yes, you will find them in the study." His plan was quite simple. If anyone met him, he would pretend to be a tradesman. But there was no need for this subterfuge. He was able, after crossing an empty hall, to enter a dining-room which also had no one in it, but which, through the panes of a glass partition that separated the dining-room from the study, afforded him a view of Prasville and his five companions. Prasville opened all the drawers with the aid of false keys. Next he examined all the papers, while his companions took down the books from the shelves, shook the pages of each separately, and felt inside the bindings. "Of course it's a paper they're looking for," said Lupin. "Bank-notes, perhaps." Prasville exclaimed. "What rot! We shan't find a thing!" Yet he obviously did not abandon all hope of discovering what he wanted, for he suddenly seized the four bottles in a liqueur stand, took out the four stoppers, and inspected them. "Hello?" thought Lupin. "Now he's going for decanter stoppers. Then it's not a question of a paper. Well, I give it up." Prasville next lifted and examined different objects, and he asked, "How often have you been here?"
6 times last winter," was the reply.
"And you have searched the house thoroughly?"
"Every one of the rooms, for days at a time, while he was visiting his constituency."
"Still, still." And he added, "Has he no servant at present?"
"No, he is looking for one. He has his meals out, and the portress keeps the house as best she can. The woman is devoted to us."
Prasville persisted in his investigations for nearly an hour and a half, shifting and fingering all the knick-knacks, but taking care to put everything back exactly where he found it. At 9 o'clock, however, the two detectives who had followed Daubrecq burst into the study.
"He's coming back."
"On foot?"
"Yes."
"Have we time?"
"Oh, dear, yes."
Prasville and the men from the police office withdrew, without undue haste, after taking a last glance round the room to make sure that there was nothing to betray their visit. The position was becoming critical for Lupin. He ran the risk of knocking up against Daubrecq if he went away, or of not being able to get out if he remained. But on ascertaining that the dining-room windows afforded a direct means of exit to the square, he resolved to stay. Besides, the opportunity of obtaining a close view of Daubrecq was too good to refuse, and as Daubrecq had been out to dinner, there was not much chance of his entering the dining-room. Lupin, therefore, waited, holding himself ready to hide behind a velvet curtain that could be drawn across the glazed partition in case of need. He heard the sound of doors opening and shutting. Someone walked into the study and switched on the light. He recognized Daubrecq. The deputy was a stout, thick-set, bull-necked man, very nearly bald, with a fringe of grey whiskers round his chin, and wearing a pair of black eyeglasses under his spectacles, for his eyes were weak and strained. Lupin noticed the powerful features, the square chin, the prominent cheekbones. The hands were brawny and covered with hair, the legs bowed, and he walked with a stoop, bearing first on one hip and then on the other, which gave him something of the gait of a gorilla. But the face was topped by an enormous, lined forehead, indented with hollows and dotted with bumps. There was something bestial, something savage, something repulsive about the man's whole personality. Lupin remembered that, in the Chamber of Deputies, Daubrecq was nicknamed the Wild Man of the Woods, and that he was so labelled not only because he stood aloof and hardly ever mixed with his fellow members, but also because of his appearance, his behaviour, his peculiar gait, and his remarkable muscular development. He sat down to his desk, took a meerschaum pipe from his pocket, selected a packet of Caporal among several packets of tobacco which lay drying in a bowl, tore open the wrapper, filled his pipe and lit it. Then he began to write letters. Presently he ceased his work and sat thinking, with his attention fixed on a spot on his desk. He lifted a little stamp-box and examined it. Next he verified the position of different articles which Prasville had touched and replaced, and he searched them with his eyes, felt them with his hands, bending over them as though certain signs, known to himself alone, were able to tell him what he wished to know. Lastly, he grasped the knob on an electric bell-push and rang. The portress appeared a minute later. He asked, "They've been, haven't they?" And when the woman hesitated about replying, he insisted, "Come, come, Clémence, did you open this stamp-box?"
"No, sir."
"Well, I fastened the lid down with a little strip of gummed paper. The strip has been broken."
"But I assure you," the woman began.
"Why tell lies?" he said, "considering that I myself instructed you to lend yourself to those visits."
The fact is
that you want to keep on good terms with both sides."
"Very well."
He handed her a 50-franc note and repeated, "Have they been?"
"Yes."
"The same men as in the spring?"
"Yes, all 5 of them, with another one who ordered them about."
"A tall, dark man?"
"Yes."
Lupin saw Daubrecq's mouth hardening, and Daubrecq continued, "Is that all?"
"There was one more, who came after they did, and joined them, and then, just now, 2 more, the pair who usually keep watch outside the house."
"Did they remain in the study?"
"Yes, sir."
"And they went away when I came back, a few minutes before, perhaps?"
"Yes, sir."
"That will do." The woman left the room. Daubrecq returned to his letter-writing. Then, stretching out his arm, he made some marks on a white writing-tablet at the end of his desk,
and rested it against the desk, as though he wished to keep it in sight. The marks were figures, and Lupin was able to read the following subtraction sum. 9 less 8 = 1. And Daubrecq, speaking between his teeth, thoughtfully uttered the syllables. 8 from 9 leaves 1. There's not a doubt about that, he added aloud. He wrote one more letter, a very short one, and addressed the envelope with an inscription which Lupin was able to decipher when the letter was placed beside the writing-tablet. To M. Prasville, Secretary-General of the Prefecture of Police. Then he rang the bell again. Clémence, he said to the portress, did you go to school as a child? Yes, sir, of course I did. And were you taught arithmetic? Why, sir. Well, you're not very good at subtraction. What makes you say that? Because you don't know that 9 minus 8 = 1, and that, you see, is a fact of the highest importance. Life becomes impossible if you are ignorant of that fundamental truth. He rose as he spoke, and walked round the room, with his hands behind his back, swaying upon his hips. He did so once more. Then, stopping at the dining-room, he opened the door. For that matter, there's another way of putting the problem. Take 8 from 9, and 1 remains. And the one who remains is here, eh? Correct. And Monsieur supplies us with a striking proof, does he not? He patted the velvet curtain in which Lupin had hurriedly wrapped himself. Upon my word, sir, you must be stifling under this. Not to say that I might have amused myself by sticking a dagger through the curtain. Remember Hamlet's madness and Polonius's death. How now? A rat? Dead. For a ducat, dead. Come along, Mr. Polonius, come out of your hole. It was one of those positions to which Lupin was not accustomed, and which he loathed. To catch others in a trap and pull their leg was all very well, but it was a very different thing to have people teasing him, and roaring with laughter at his expense. Yet what could he answer back? You look a little pale, Mr. Polonius. Hello, why, it's the respectable old gentleman who has been hanging about the square for some days. So you belong to the police too, Mr. Polonius? There, there, pull yourself together. I shan't hurt you. But you see, Clémence, how right my calculation was. You told me that 9 spies had been to the house. I counted a troop of 8 as I came along, 8 of them in the distance, down the avenue. Take 8 from 9, and 1 remains, the one who evidently remained behind to see what he could see. Ecce homo. Well, and then, said Lupin, who felt a mad craving to fly at the fellow and reduce him to silence. And then? Nothing at all, my good man. What more do you want? The farce is over. I will only ask you to take this little note to Master Prasville, your employer. Clémence, please see Mr. Polonius out, and if ever he calls again, fling open the doors wide to him. Pray look upon this as your home, Mr. Polonius. Your servant, sir. Lupin hesitated. He would have liked to talk big and to come out with a farewell phrase, a parting speech, like an actor making a showy exit from the stage, and at least to disappear with the honours of war. But his defeat was so pitiable that he could think of nothing better than to bang his hat on his head and stamp his feet as he followed the portress down the hall. It was a poor revenge. "You rascally beggar!" he shouted, once he was outside the door, shaking his fist at Daubrecq's windows. "Wretch! Scum of the earth! Deputy, you shall pay for this! Oh, he allows himself! Oh, he has the cheek to— Well, I swear to you, my fine fellow, that one of these days—" He was foaming with rage, all the more as, in his innermost heart, he recognized the strength of his new enemy, and could not deny the masterly fashion in which he had managed this business. Daubrecq's coolness, the assurance with which he hoaxed the police officials, the contempt with which he lent himself to their visits at his house, and above all, his wonderful self-possession, his easy bearing, and the impertinence of his conduct in the presence of the 9th person who was spying on him. All this denoted a man of character, a strong man with a well-balanced mind, lucid, bold, sure of himself and of the cards in his hand. But what were those cards? What game was he playing? Who held the stakes? And how did the players stand on either side? Lupin could not tell. Knowing nothing, he flung himself headlong into the thick of the fray, between adversaries desperately involved, though he himself was in total ignorance of their positions, their weapons, their resources, and their secret plans. For when all was said, he could not admit that the object of all those efforts was to obtain possession of a crystal stopper. One thing alone pleased him. Daubrecq had not penetrated his disguise. Daubrecq believed him to be in the employ of the police. Neither Daubrecq nor the police, therefore, suspected the intrusion of a third thief in the business. This was his one and only trump, a trump that gave him a liberty of action to which he attached the greatest importance. Without further delay, he opened the letter which Daubrecq had handed him for the Secretary-General of Police. It contained these few lines. "Within reach of your hand, my dear Prasville, within reach of your hand. You touched it. A little more, and the trick was done. But you're too big a fool, and to think that they couldn't hit upon anyone better than you to make me bite the dust. Poor old France! Good-bye, Prasville. But if I catch you in the act, it will be a bad lookout for you. My maxim is to shoot at sight. Daubrecq." "Within reach of your hand," repeated Lupin, after reading the note. "And to think that the rogue may be writing the truth. The most elementary hiding-places are the safest. We must look into this all the same. And also, we must find out why Daubrecq is the object of such strict supervision, and obtain a few particulars about the fellow generally." The information supplied to Lupin by a private inquiry office consisted of the following details. "Alexis Daubrecq, deputy of the Bouches-du-Rhône for the past 2 years, sits among the independent members. Political opinions not very clearly defined, but electoral position exceedingly strong, because of the enormous sums which he spends in nursing his constituency. No private income. Nevertheless, has a house in Paris, a villa at Enghien, and another at Nice, and loses heavily at play, though no one knows where the money comes from. Has great influence and obtains all he wants without making up to ministers or, apparently, having either friends or connections in political circles." "That's a trade docket," said Lupin to himself. "What I want is a domestic docket, a police docket, which will tell me about the gentleman's private life, and enable me to work more easily in this darkness, and to know if I'm not getting myself into a tangle by bothering about the Daubrecq bird. And time's getting short, hang it." One of the residences which Lupin occupied at that period, and which he used oftener than any of the others, was in the rue Chateaubriand, near the Arc de l'Étoile. He was known there by the name of Michel Beaumont. He had a snug flat here, and was looked after by a manservant, Achille, who was utterly devoted to his interests, and whose chief duty was to receive and repeat the telephone messages addressed to Lupin by his followers. Lupin, on returning home, learnt with great astonishment that a woman had been waiting to see him for over an hour. "What? Why, no one ever comes to see me here. Is she young?" "No, I don't think so." "You don't think so? She's wearing a lace shawl over her head, instead of a hat, and you can't see her face. She's more like a clerk, or a woman employed in a shop. She's not well dressed." "Whom did she ask for?" "Monsieur Michel Beaumont," replied the servant. "Queer. And why has she called?" "All she said was that it was about the Enghien business. So I thought that—" "What? The Enghien business? Then she knows that I am mixed up in that business? She knows that, by applying here, I could not get anything out of her, but I thought all the same that I had better let her in." "Quite right. Where is she?" "In the drawing-room. I've put on the lights." Lupin walked briskly across the hall and opened the door of the drawing-room. "What are you talking about?" he said to his man. "There's no one here." "No one here?" said Achille, running up. And the room, in fact, was empty. "Well, on my word, this takes the cake," cried the servant. "It wasn't 20 minutes ago that I came and had a look to make sure. She was sitting over there, and there's nothing wrong with my eyesight, you know." "Look here, look here," said Lupin irritably. "Where were you while the woman was waiting?" "In the hall, governor. I never left the hall for a second. I should have seen her go out, blow it." "Still, she's not here now."
"So I see," moaned the man, quite flabbergasted.
"She must have got tired of waiting and gone away. But dash it all, I should like to know how she got out."
"How she got out?" said Lupin. "It doesn't take a wizard to tell that."
"What do you mean?"
"She got out through the window. Look, it's still ajar. We are on the ground floor. The street is almost always deserted in the evenings. There's no doubt about it."
He had looked around him and satisfied himself that nothing had been taken away or moved. The room, for that matter, contained no knick-knack of any value, no important paper that might have explained the woman's visit, followed by her sudden disappearance. And yet why that inexplicable flight?
"Has anyone telephoned?" he asked.
"No."
"Any letters?"
"Yes, one letter by the last post."
"Where is it?"
"I put it on your mantelpiece, governor, as usual."
Lupin's bedroom was next to the drawing-room, but Lupin had permanently bolted the door between the two. He therefore had to go through the hall again. Lupin switched on the electric light, and the next moment said,
"I don't see it."
"Yes, I put it next to the flower-bowl."
"There's nothing here at all."
"You must be looking in the wrong place, governor." but Achille moved the bowl, lifted the clock, bent down to the grate, in vain. The letter was not there.
"Oh, blast it! Blast it!" he muttered. "She's done it. She's taken it. And then, when she had the letter, she cleared out. Oh, the slut!"
Lupin said,
"You're mad. There's no way through between the two rooms."
"Then who did take it, Governor?" They were both of them silent. Lupin strove to control his anger and collect his ideas. He asked, "Did you look at the envelope?"
"Yes."
"Anything particular about it?"
"Yes, it looked as if it had been written in a hurry, or scribbled, rather."
"How was the address worded? Do you remember?" asked Lupin, in a voice strained with anxiety.
"Yes, I remembered it, because it struck me as funny."
"But speak, will you, speak?"
"It said, Monsieur de Beaumont, Michel."
Lupin took his servant by the shoulders and shook him.
"It said de Beaumont, are you sure? And Michel after Beaumont?"
"Quite certain."
"Ah," muttered Lupin, with a choking throat, "it was a letter from Gilbert."
He stood motionless, a little pale, with drawn features. There was no doubt about it, the letter was from Gilbert. It was the form of address which, by Lupin's orders, Gilbert had used for years in corresponding with him. Gilbert had at last, after long waiting and by dint of endless artifices, found a means of getting the letter posted from his prison, and had hastily written to him. And now the letter was intercepted. What did it say? What instructions had the unhappy prisoner given? What help was he praying for? What stratagem did he suggest? Lupin looked round the room, which, contrary to the drawing-room, contained important papers, but none of the locks had been forced, and he was compelled to admit that the woman had no other object than to get hold of Gilbert's letter. Constraining himself to keep his temper, he asked, "Did the letter come while the woman was here?"
"At the same time. The porter rang at the same moment."
"Could she see the envelope?"
"Yes."
The conclusion was evident. It remained to discover how the visitor had been able to effect her theft. By slipping from one window to the other, outside the flat? Impossible. Lupin found the window of his room shut. By opening the communicating door? Impossible. Lupin found it locked and barred with its two inner bolts. Nevertheless, a person cannot pass through a wall by a mere operation of will. To go in or out of a room requires a passage, and as the act was accomplished in the space of a few minutes, it was necessary, in the circumstances, that the passage should be previously in existence, that it should already have been contrived in the wall, and, of course, known to the woman. This hypothesis simplified the search by concentrating it upon the door, for the wall was quite bare, without a cupboard, chimney-piece or hangings of any kind, and unable to conceal the least outlet. Lupin went back to the drawing-room and prepared to make a study of the door. But he at once gave a start. He perceived, at the first glance, that the left lower panel of the six small panels contained within the crossbars of the door no longer occupied its normal position, and that the light did not fall straight upon it. On leaning forward, he saw two little tin tacks sticking out on either side, and holding the panel in place, similar to a wooden board behind a picture-frame. He had only to shift these. The panel at once came out. Achille gave a cry of amazement, but Lupin objected. "Well, and what then? We are no better off than before. Here is an empty oblong, 8 or 9 inches wide by 16 inches wide. You're not going to pretend that a woman can slip through an opening which would not admit the thinnest child of 10 years old."
"No, but she can have put her arm through and drawn the bolts."
"The bottom bolt, yes," said Lupin, "but the top bolt, no. The distance is far too great. Try for yourself and see." Achille tried and had to give up the attempt. Lupin did not reply. He stood thinking for a long time. Then suddenly he said, "Give me my hat, my coat." He hurried off, urged by an imperative idea. And the moment he reached the street, he sprang into a taxi. "Rue Matignon, quick!" As soon as they came to the house where he had been robbed of the crystal stopper, he jumped out of the cab, opened his private entrance, went upstairs, ran to the drawing-room, turned on the light, and crouched at the foot of the door leading to his bedroom. He had guessed right. One of the little panels was loosed in the same manner. And just as in his other flat in the Rue Chateaubriand, the opening was large enough to admit a man's arm and shoulder, but not to allow him to draw the upper bolt.
"Hang!" he shouted, unable any longer to master the rage that had been seething within him for the last 2 hours. "Blast! Shall I never have finished with this confounded business?"
In fact, an incredible ill-luck seemed to dog his footsteps, compelling him to grope about at random, without permitting him to use the elements of success, which his own persistency or the very force of things placed within his grasp. Gilbert gave him the crystal stopper. Gilbert sent him a letter, and both had disappeared at that very moment. And it was not, as he had until then believed, a series of fortuitous and independent circumstances. No, it was manifestly the effect of an adverse will, pursuing a definite object with prodigious ability and incredible boldness, attacking him, Lupin, in the recesses of his safest retreats, and baffling him with blows so severe and so unexpected that he did not know even against whom he had to defend himself. Never in the course of his adventures had he encountered such obstacles as now. And little by little, deep down within himself, there grew a haunting dread of the future. A date loomed before his eyes, the terrible date which he unconsciously assigned to the law to perform its work of vengeance, the date upon which, in the light of a wan April morning, two men would mount the scaffold, two men who had stood by him, two comrades whom he had been unable to save from paying the awful penalty.
Chapter 3. The Home Life of Alexis Daubrecq. When Daubrecq the deputy came in from lunch on the day after the police had searched his house, he was stopped by Clémence, his portress, who told him that she had found a cook who could be thoroughly relied on. The cook arrived a few minutes later and produced first-rate characters, signed by people with whom it was easy to take up her references. She was a very active woman, although of a certain age, and agreed to do the work of the house by herself, without the help of a manservant, this being a condition upon which Daubrecq insisted. Her last place was with a member of the Chamber of Deputies, Comte Soleva, to whom Daubrecq at once telephoned. The Count's steward gave her a perfect character, and she was engaged. As soon as she had fetched her trunk, she set to work and cleaned and scrubbed until it was time to cook the dinner. Daubrecq dined and went out. At 11 o'clock, after the portress had gone to bed, the cook cautiously opened the garden gate. A man came up. "Is that you?" she asked. "Yes, it's I, Lupin." She took him to her bedroom on the third floor, overlooking the garden, and at once burst into lamentations. "More of your tricks, and nothing but tricks. Why can't you leave me alone, instead of sending me to do your dirty work?" "How can I help it, you dear old Victoire? When I want a person of respectable appearance and incorruptible morals, I think of you. You ought to be flattered." "That's all you care about me," she cried. "You run me into danger once more, and you think it's funny." "What are you risking?" "How do you mean, what am I risking? All my characters are false." "Characters are always false." "And suppose Monsieur Daubrecq finds out? Suppose he makes inquiries?" "He has made inquiries." "Eh? What's that?" "He has telephoned to the steward of Comte Soleva, in whose service you say that you have had the honour of being." "There, you see, I'm done for." "The Count's steward could not say enough in your praise." "He does not know me." "But I know him. I got him his situation with Comte Soleva. So you understand." Victoire seemed to calm down a little. "Well," she said, "God's will be done, or rather yours. And what do you expect me to do in all this?" "First, to put me up. You were my wet nurse once. You can very well give me half your room now. I'll sleep in the armchair."
"And next?"
"Next, to supply me with such food as I want."
"And next?"
"Next, to undertake, with me and under my direction, a regular series of searches, with a view..."
"To what?"
"To discovering the precious object of which I spoke to you."
"What's that?"
"A crystal stopper."
"A crystal stopper! Saints above! A nice business! And if we don't find your confounded stopper, what then?"
Lupin took her gently by the arm, and in a serious voice, "If we don't find it, Gilbert, young Gilbert, whom you know and love, will stand every chance of losing his head, and so will Vaucheray."
"Vaucheray I don't mind, a dirty rascal like him, but Gilbert..."
"Have you seen the papers this evening? Things are looking worse than ever. Vaucheray, as might be expected, accuses Gilbert of stabbing the valet, and it so happens that the knife which Vaucheray used belonged to Gilbert. That came out this morning, whereupon Gilbert, who is intelligent in his way, but easily frightened, blithered and launched forth into stories and lies which will end in his undoing. That's how the matter stands. Will you help me?" Thenceforth, for several days, Lupin moulded his existence upon Daubrecq's, beginning his investigations the moment the deputy left the house. He pursued them methodically, dividing each room into sections which he did not abandon until he had been through the tiniest nooks and corners, and, so to speak, exhausted every possible device.
Victoire searched also, and nothing was forgotten. Table legs, chair rungs, floorboards, mouldings, mirror and picture frames, clocks, plinths, curtain borders, telephone holders, and electric fittings. Everything that an ingenious imagination could have selected as a hiding-place was overhauled. And they also watched the deputy's least actions, his most unconscious movements, the expression of his face, the books which he read, and the letters which he wrote. It was easy enough. He seemed to live his life in the light of day. No door was ever shut. He received no visits, and his existence worked with mechanical regularity. He went to the chamber in the afternoon, to the club in the evening. "Still," said Lupin, "there must be something that's not orthodox behind all this." "There's nothing of the sort," moaned Victoire. "You're wasting your time, and we shall be bowled out." The presence of the detectives and their habit of walking up and down outside the windows drove her mad. She refused to admit that they were there for any other purpose than to trap her, Victoire. And each time that she went shopping, she was quite surprised that one of those men did not lay his hand upon her shoulder. One day she returned all upset. Her basket of provisions was shaking on her arm. "What's the matter, my dear Victoire?" said Lupin. "You're looking green." "Green? I dare say I do. So would you look green." She had to sit down, and it was only after making repeated efforts that she succeeded in stuttering. A man spoke to me. At the fruiterer's." "By jingo! Did he want you to run away with him?" "No. He gave me a letter." "Then what are you complaining about? It was a love letter, of course." "No. It's for your governor," said he. "My governor?" I said. "Yes," he said, "for the gentleman who's staying in your room." "What's that?" This time Lupin had started. "Give it here," he said, snatching the letter from her. The envelope bore no address, but there was another inside it on which he read, "Monsieur Arsène Lupin, care of Victoire." "The devil," he said. "This is a bit thick." He tore open the second envelope. It contained a sheet of paper with the following words, written in large capitals: "Everything you are doing is useless and dangerous. Give it up." Victoire uttered one moan and fainted. As for Lupin, he felt himself blush up to his eyes, as though he had been grossly insulted. He experienced all the humiliation which a duelist would undergo if he heard the most secret advice which he had received from his seconds repeated aloud by a mocking adversary. However, he held his tongue. Victoire went back to her work. As for him, he remained in his room all day, thinking. That night he did not sleep, and he kept saying to himself, "What is the good of thinking? I am up against one of those problems which are not solved by any amount of thought. It is certain that I am not alone in the matter, and that between Daubrecq and the police there is, in addition to the third thief that I am, a fourth thief who is working on his own account, who knows me and who reads my game clearly. But who is this fourth thief? And am I mistaken, by any chance? And, oh, rot, let's get to sleep." But he could not sleep, and a good part of the night went in this way. At 4 o'clock in the morning he seemed to hear a noise in the house. He jumped up quickly, and from the top of the staircase saw Daubrecq go down the first flight and turn toward the garden. A minute later, after opening the gate, the deputy returned with a man whose head was buried in an enormous fur collar and showed him into his study. Lupin had taken his precautions in view of any such contingency. As the windows of the study and those of his own bedroom, both of which were at the back of the house, overlooked the garden, he fastened a rope-ladder to his balcony, unrolled it softly, and let himself down by it until it was level with the top of the study windows. These windows were closed by shutters, but as they were bowed, there remained a semicircular space at the top, and Lupin, though he could not hear, was able to see all that went on inside. He then realized that the person whom he had taken for a man was a woman who was still young, though her dark hair was mingled with grey, a tall woman, elegantly but quite unobtrusively dressed, whose handsome features bore the expression of weariness and melancholy which long suffering gives. "Where the deuce have I seen her before?" Lupin asked himself, "for I certainly know that face, that look, that expression." She stood leaning against the table, listening impassively to Daubrecq, who was also standing and who was talking very excitedly. He had his back turned to Lupin, but Lupin, leaning forward, caught sight of a glass in which the deputy's image was reflected, and he was startled to see the strange look in his eyes, the air of fierce and brutal desire with which Daubrecq was staring at his visitor. It seemed to embarrass her, too, for she sat down with lowered lids. Then Daubrecq leaned over her, and it appeared as though he were ready to fling his long arms, with their huge hands, around her. And suddenly Lupin perceived great tears rolling down the woman's sad face. Whether or not it was the sight of those tears that made Daubrecq lose his head, with a brusque movement he clutched the woman and drew her to him. She repelled him with a violence full of hatred, and after a brief struggle, during which Lupin caught a glimpse of the man's bestial and contorted features, the two of them stood face to face, railing at each other like mortal enemies. Then they stopped. Daubrecq sat down. There was mischief in his face, and sarcasm as well. And he began to talk again, with sharp taps on the table, as though he were dictating terms. She no longer stirred. She sat haughtily in her chair and towered over him, absent-minded, with roaming eyes. Lupin, captivated by that powerful and sorrowful countenance, continued to watch her, and he was vainly seeking to remember of what or of whom she reminded him, when he noticed that she had turned her head slightly, and that she was imperceptibly moving her arm. And her arm strayed farther and farther, and her hand crept along the table, and Lupin saw that, at the end of the table, there stood a water-bottle with a gold-topped stopper. The hand reached the water-bottle, felt it, rose gently, and seized the stopper. A quick movement of the head, a glance, and the stopper was put back in its place. Obviously it was not what the woman hoped to find.
"Dash it!" said Lupin. "She's after the crystal stopper, too. The matter is becoming more complicated daily. There's no doubt about it."
But on renewing his observation of the visitor, he was astounded to note the sudden and unexpected expression of her countenance, a terrible, implacable, ferocious expression. And he saw that her hand was continuing its stealthy progress round the table, and with an uninterrupted and crafty sliding movement, it was pushing back books, and slowly and surely approaching a dagger whose blade gleamed among the scattered papers. It gripped the handle. Daubrecq went on talking. Behind his back the hand rose steadily, little by little, and Lupin saw the woman's desperate and furious eyes fixed upon the spot in the neck where she intended to plant the knife. "You are doing a very silly thing, fair lady," thought Lupin. And he already began to turn over in his mind the best means of escaping and of taking Victoire with him. She hesitated, however, with uplifted arm. But it was only a momentary weakness. She clenched her teeth. Her whole face, contracted with hatred, became yet further convulsed, and she made the dread movement. At the same instant Daubrecq crouched, and springing from his seat, turned and seized the woman's frail wrist in mid-air. Oddly enough, he addressed no reproach to her, as though the deed which she had attempted surprised him no more than any ordinary, very natural, simple act. He shrugged his shoulders, like a man accustomed to that sort of danger, and strode up and down in silence. She had dropped the weapon and was now crying, holding her head between her hands, with sobs that shook her whole frame. He next came up to her and said a few words, once more tapping the table as he spoke. She made a sign in the negative, and when he insisted, she in her turn stamped her foot on the floor and exclaimed loud enough for Lupin to hear, "Never, never!" Thereupon, without another word, Daubrecq fetched the fur coat which she had brought with her and hung it over the woman's shoulders while she shrouded her face in a lace wrap, and he showed her out. 2 minutes later the garden gate was locked again. "Pity I can't run after that strange person," thought Lupin, "and have a chat with her about the Daubrecq bird. Seems to me that we two could do a good stroke of business together." In any case, there was one point to be cleared up. Daubrecq, the deputy, whose life was so orderly, so apparently respectable, was in the habit of receiving visits at night, when his house was no longer watched by the police. He sent Victoire to arrange with two members of his gang to keep watch for several days, and he himself remained awake next night. As on the previous morning, he heard a noise at 4 o'clock. As on the previous morning, the deputy let someone in. Lupin ran down his ladder, and when he came to the free space above the shutters, saw a man crawling at Daubrecq's feet, flinging his arms round Daubrecq's knees in frenzied despair, and weeping, weeping convulsively. Daubrecq, laughing, pushed him away repeatedly, but the man clung to him. He behaved almost like one out of his mind, and at last, in a genuine fit of madness, half rose to his feet, took the deputy by the throat, and flung him back in a chair. Daubrecq struggled, powerless at first, while his veins swelled in his temples. But soon, with a strength far beyond the ordinary, he regained the mastery and deprived his adversary of all power of movement. Then, holding him with one hand, with the other he gave him two great smacks in the face. The man got up slowly. He was livid and could hardly stand on his legs. He waited for a moment, as though to recover his self-possession.
Then, with a terrifying calmness, he drew a revolver from his pocket and levelled it at Daubrecq. Daubrecq did not flinch. He even smiled, with a defiant air, and without displaying more excitement than if he had been aimed at with a toy pistol. The man stood for perhaps 15 or 20 seconds, facing his enemy, with outstretched arm. Then, with the same deliberate slowness, revealing a self-control which was all the more impressive because it followed upon a fit of extreme excitement, he put up his revolver, and from another pocket produced his note-case. Daubrecq took a step forward. The man opened the pocket-book. A sheaf of bank-notes appeared in sight. Daubrecq seized and counted them. They were 1,000-franc notes, and there were 30 of them. The man looked on without a movement of revolt, without a protest. He obviously understood the futility of words. Daubrecq was one of those who do not relent. Why should his visitor waste time in beseeching him, or even in revenging himself upon him by uttering vain threats and insults? He had no hope of striking that unassailable enemy. Even Daubrecq's death would not deliver him from Daubrecq. He took his hat and went away. At 11 o'clock in the morning, Victoire, on returning from her shopping, handed Lupin a note from his accomplices. He opened it and read, "The man who came to see Daubrecq last night is Langeroux, the deputy leader of the independent left, a poor man with a large family." "Come," said Lupin, "Daubrecq is nothing more nor less than a blackmailer, but by Jupiter he has jolly effective ways of going to work." Events tended to confirm Lupin's supposition. 3 days later he saw another visitor hand Daubrecq an important sum of money, and 2 days after that one came and left a pearl necklace behind him. The first was called Dachaumont, a senator and ex-cabinet minister. The second was the Marquis d'Albufex, a Bonapartist deputy, formerly chief political agent in France of Prince Napoleon. The scene, in each of these cases, was very similar to Langeroux, the deputy's interview. A violent, tragic scene, ending in Daubrecq's victory. "And so on and so forth," thought Lupin, when he received these particulars. "I've been present at 4 visits. I shall know no more if there are 10 or 20 or 30. It is enough for me to learn the names of the visitors from my friends on sentry-go outside. Shall I go and call on them? What for? They have no reason to confide in me. On the other hand, am I to stay on here, delayed by investigations which lead to nothing, and which Victoire can continue just as well without me?" He was very much perplexed. The news of the inquiry into the case of Gilbert and Vaucheray was becoming worse and worse. The days were slipping by, and not an hour passed without his asking himself, in anguish, whether all his efforts, granting that he succeeded, would not end in farcical results, absolutely foreign to the aim which he was pursuing. For after all, supposing that he did fathom Daubrecq's underhand dealings, would that give him the means of rescuing Gilbert and Vaucheray? That day an incident occurred which put an end to his indecision. After lunch, Victoire heard snatches of a conversation which Daubrecq held with someone on the telephone. Lupin gathered from what Victoire reported that the deputy had an appointment with a lady for 8:30, and that he was going to take her to a theatre. "I shall get a pit-tier box, like the one we had 6 weeks ago," Daubrecq had said, and he added with a laugh, "I hope I shall not have the burglars in during that time." There was not a doubt in Lupin's mind. Daubrecq was about to spend his evening in the same manner in which he had spent the evening 6 weeks ago, while they were breaking into his villa at Enghien. To know the person whom he was to meet, and perhaps thus to discover how Gilbert and Vaucheray had learnt that Daubrecq would be away from 8 o'clock in the evening until 1 o'clock in the morning, these were matters of the utmost importance. Lupin left the house in the afternoon, with Victoire's assistance. He knew through her that Daubrecq was coming home for dinner earlier than usual. He went to his flat in the Rue Chateaubriand, telephoned for 3 of his friends, dressed and made himself up in his favourite character of a Russian prince, with fair hair and moustache and short-cut whiskers. The accomplices arrived in a motor-car. At that moment, Achille, his man, brought him a telegram addressed to Monsieur Michel Beaumont, Rue Chateaubriand, which ran, "Do not come to theatre this evening. Danger of your intervention spoiling everything." There was a flower-vase on the chimney-piece beside him. Lupin took it and smashed it to pieces.
"That's it! That's it!" he snarled. "They are playing with me as I usually play with others. Same behaviour, same tricks. Only there's this difference."
What difference? He hardly knew. The truth was that he too was baffled and disconcerted to the inmost recesses of his being, and that he was continuing to act only from obstinacy, from a sense of duty, so to speak, and without putting his ordinary good humour and high spirits into the work. "Come along," he said to his accomplices. By his instructions, the chauffeur set them down near the square Lamartine,
but kept the motor going. Lupin foresaw that Daubrecq, in order to escape the detectives watching the house, would jump into the first taxi, and he did not intend to be outdistanced. He had not allowed for Daubrecq's cleverness. At 7:30, both leaves of the garden gate were flung open. A bright light flashed, and a motorcycle darted across the road, skirted the square, turned in front of the motor-car, and shot away toward the Bois at a speed so great that they would have been mad to go in pursuit of it.
"Good-bye, Daisy," said Lupin, trying to jest, but really overcome with rage.
He eyed his accomplices in the hope that one of them would venture to give a mocking smile. How pleased he would have been to vent his nerves on them. "Let's go home," he said to his companions. He gave them some dinner, then he smoked a cigar, and they set off again in the car, and went the round of the theatres, beginning with those which were giving light operas and musical comedies, for which he presumed that Daubrecq and his lady would have a preference. He took a stall, inspected the lower-tier boxes, and went away again. He next drove to the more serious theatres, the Renaissance, the Gymnase. At last, at 10 o'clock in the evening, he saw a pit-tier box at the Vaudeville, almost entirely protected from inspection by its two screens, and on tipping the box-keeper was told that it contained a short, stout, elderly gentleman and a lady who was wearing a thick lace veil. The next box was free. He took it, went back to his friends to give them their instructions, and sat down near the couple. During the entr'acte, when the lights went up, he perceived Daubrecq's profile. The lady remained at the back of the box, invisible. The two were speaking in a low voice, and when the curtain rose again, they went on speaking, but in such a way that Lupin could not distinguish a word. 10 minutes passed. Someone tapped at their door. It was one of the men from the box office.
"Are you Monsieur le député Daubrecq, sir?" he asked.
"Yes," said Daubrecq, in a voice of surprise.
"But how do you know my name?"
"There's a gentleman asking for you on the telephone. He told me to go to Box 22."
"But who is it?"
"Monsieur le Marquis d'Albufex."
"Hey?"
"What am I to say, sir?"
"I'm coming, I'm coming."
Daubrecq rose hurriedly from his seat and followed the clerk to the box office. He was not yet out of sight when Lupin sprang from his box, worked the lock of the next door, and sat down beside the lady. She gave a stifled cry.
"Hush!" he said. "I have to speak to you. It is most important."
"Ah!" she said between her teeth.
"Arsène Lupin!"
He was dumbfounded. For a moment he sat quiet, open-mouthed. The woman knew him. And not only did she know him, but she had recognized him through his disguise. Accustomed though he was to the most extraordinary and unusual events, this disconcerted him. He did not even dream of protesting, and stammered,
So you know?
He snatched at the lady's veil and pulled it aside before she had time to defend herself.
What?
He muttered, with increased amazement.
Is it possible?
It was the woman whom he had seen at Daubrecq's a few days earlier, the woman who had raised her dagger against Daubrecq, and who had intended to stab him with all the strength of her hatred. It was her turn to be taken aback.
"What, have you seen me before?"
"Yes, the other night at his house.
I saw what you tried to do."
She made a movement to escape. He held her back, and speaking with great eagerness,
"I must know who you are," he said. "That was why I had Daubrecq telephoned for."
She looked aghast.
"Do you mean to say it was not the Marquis d'Albufex?"
"No, it was one of my assistants."
"Then Daubrecq will come back?"
"Yes, but we have time. Listen to me. We must meet again. He is your enemy. I will save you from him."
"Why should you? What is your object?"
"Do not mistrust me. It is quite certain that our interests are identical. Where can I see you? Tomorrow, surely. At what time and where?"
"Well..."
She looked at him with obvious hesitation, not knowing what to do, on the point of speaking, and yet full of uneasiness and doubt. He pressed her.
"Oh, I entreat you. Answer me just one word, and at once. It would be a pity for him to find me here. I entreat you."
She answered sharply. "My name doesn't matter. We will see each other first, and you shall explain to me."
"Yes, we will meet. Listen, tomorrow, at 3 o'clock, at the corner of the boulevard."
At that exact moment, the door of the box opened, so to speak, with a bang, and Daubrecq entered.
"Rats!"
Lupin mumbled under his breath, furious at being caught before obtaining what he wanted. Daubrecq gave a chuckle.
"So that's it. I thought something was up. Ah, the telephone trick. A little out of date, sir. I had not gone halfway when I turned back."
He pushed Lupin to the front of the box, and sitting down beside the lady, said, "And now, my lord, who are we? A servant at the police office, probably. There's a professional look about that mug of yours." He stared hard at Lupin, who did not move a muscle, and tried to put a name to the face, but failed to recognize the man whom he had called Polonius. Lupin, without taking his eyes from Daubrecq either, reflected. He would not for anything in the world have thrown up the game at that point, or neglected this favorable opportunity of coming to an understanding with his mortal enemy. The woman sat in her corner, motionless, and watched them both. Lupin said, "Let us go outside, sir. That will make our interview easier." "No, my lord, here," grinned the deputy. "It will take place here, presently, during the entr'acte. Then we shall not be disturbing anybody." "But save your breath, my man. You shan't budge." And he took Lupin by the coat collar, with the obvious intention of not letting go of him before the interval. A rash move. Was it likely that Lupin would consent to remain in such an attitude, especially before a woman to whom he had offered his alliance, a woman, and he now thought of it for the first time, who was distinctly good-looking, and whose grave beauty attracted him? His whole pride as a man rose at the thought. However, he said nothing. He accepted the heavy weight of the hand on his shoulder, and even sat bent in two, as though beaten, powerless, almost frightened. "Clever," said the deputy scoffingly. "We don't seem to be swaggering quite so much." The stage was full of actors who were arguing and making a noise. Daubrecq had loosened his grasp slightly, and Lupin felt that the moment had come. With the edge of his hand, he gave him a violent blow in the hollow of the arm, as he might have done with a hatchet. The pain took Daubrecq off his guard. Lupin now released himself entirely, and sprang at the other to clutch him by the throat. But Daubrecq had at once put himself on the defensive, and stepped back, and their four hands seized one another. They gripped with superhuman energy, the whole force of the two adversaries concentrating in those hands. Daubrecq's were of monstrous size, and Lupin, caught in that iron vice, felt as though he were fighting not with a man, but with some terrible beast, a huge gorilla. They held each other against the door, bending low like a pair of wrestlers groping and trying to lay hold of each other. Their bones creaked. Whichever gave way first was bound to be caught by the throat and strangled. And all this happened amid a sudden silence, for the actors on the stage were now listening to one of their number, who was speaking in a low voice. The woman stood back flat against the partition, looking at them in terror. Had she taken sides with either of them, with a single movement, the victory would at once have been decided in that one's favour. But which of them should she assist? What could Lupin represent in her eyes? A friend? An enemy? She briskly made for the front of the box, forced back the screen, and leaning forward, seemed to give a signal. Then she returned and tried to slip to the door. Lupin, as though wishing to help her, said, "Why don't you move the chair?" He was speaking of a heavy chair which had fallen down between him and Daubrecq, and across which they were struggling. The woman stooped and pulled away the chair. That was what Lupin was waiting for. Once rid of the obstacle, he caught Daubrecq a smart kick on the shin with the tip of his patent leather boot. The result was the same as with the blow which he had given him on the arm. The pain caused a second's apprehension and distraction, of which he at once took advantage to beat down Daubrecq's outstretched hands, and to dig his 10 fingers into his adversary's throat and neck. Daubrecq struggled. Daubrecq tried to pull away the hands that were throttling him, but he was beginning to choke and felt his strength decreasing.
"Aha, you old monkey," growled Lupin, forcing him to the floor. "Why don't you shout for help? How frightened you must be of a scandal."
At the sound of the fall there came a knocking at the partition on the other side.
"Knock away, knock away," said Lupin under his breath. "The play is on the stage. This is my business, and until I've mastered this gorilla..."
It did not take him long. The deputy was choking. Lupin stunned him with a blow on the jaw, and all that remained for him to do was to take the woman away and make his escape with her before the alarm was given. But when he turned round, he saw that the woman was gone. She could not be far. Darting from the box, he set off at a run, regardless of the program sellers and check-takers. On reaching the entrance lobby, he saw her through an open door, crossing the pavement of the Chaussée d'Antin. She was stepping into a motor-car when he came up with her. The door closed behind her. He seized the handle and tried to pull at it. But a man jumped up inside and sent his fist flying into Lupin's face, with less skill but no less force than Lupin had sent his into Daubrecq's face. Stunned though he was by the blow, he nevertheless had ample time to recognize the man, in a sudden, startled vision, and also to recognize, under his chauffeur's disguise, the man who was driving the car. It was the Growler and the Masher, the two men in charge of the boats on the Enghien night, two friends of Gilbert and Vaucheray, in short, two of Lupin's own accomplices. When he reached his rooms in the Rue Chateaubriand, Lupin, after washing the blood from his face, sat for over an hour in a chair, as though overwhelmed. For the first time in his life, he was experiencing the pain of treachery. For the first time, his comrades in the fight were turning against their chief. Mechanically, to divert his thoughts, he turned to his correspondence and tore the wrapper from an evening paper. Among the late news he found the following paragraphs. The Villa Marie-Thérèse case. The real identity of Vaucheray, one of the alleged murderers of Léonard de Valet, has at last been ascertained. He is a miscreant of the worst type, a hardened criminal who has already twice been sentenced for murder in default under another name. No doubt the police will end by also discovering the real name of his accomplice, Gilbert. In any event, the examining magistrate is determined to commit the prisoners for trial as soon as possible. The public will have no reason to complain of the delays of the law. In between other newspapers and prospectuses lay a letter. Lupin jumped when he saw it. It was addressed, Monsieur de Beaumont, Michel. Oh, he gasped, a letter from Gilbert. It contained these few words. Help, Governor, I am frightened. I am frightened. Once again, Lupin spent a night alternating between sleeplessness and nightmares. Once again, he was tormented by atrocious and terrifying visions.
Chapter 4. The Chief of the Enemies.
Poor boy, murmured Lupin, when his eyes fell on Gilbert's letter next morning. How he must feel it!
On the very first day when he saw him, he had taken a liking to that well-set-up youngster, so careless, gay, and fond of life. Gilbert was devoted to him, would have accepted death at a sign from his master. And Lupin also loved his frankness, his good humour, his simplicity, his bright, open face. Gilbert, he often used to say, you are an honest man. Do you know, if I were you, I should chuck the business and become an honest man for good. After you, Governor, Gilbert would reply with a laugh. Won't you, though? No, Governor. An honest man is a chap who works and grinds. It's a taste which I may have had as a nipper, but they've made me lose it since. Who's they? Gilbert was silent. He was always silent when questioned about his early life, and all that Lupin knew was that he had been an orphan since childhood, and that he had lived all over the place, changing his name and taking up the queerest jobs. The whole thing was a mystery which no one had been able to fathom, and it did not look as though the police would make much of it either. Nor, on the other hand, did it look as though the police would consider that mystery a reason for delaying proceedings. They would send Vaucheray's accomplice for trial, under his name of Gilbert or any other name, and visit him with the same inevitable punishment.
Poor boy, repeated Lupin. They're persecuting him like this only because of me. They are afraid of his escaping, and they are in a hurry to finish the business. The verdict first, and then... the execution. Oh, the butchers! A lad of 20 who has committed no murder, who is not even an accomplice in the murder.
Alas, Lupin well knew that this was a thing impossible to prove, and that he must concentrate his efforts upon another point. But upon which? Was he to abandon the trail of the crystal stopper? He could not make up his mind to that. His one and only diversion from the search was to go to Enghien, where the Growler and the Masher lived, and make sure that nothing had been seen of them since the murder at the Villa Marie-Thérèse. Apart from this, he applied himself to the question of Daubrecq and nothing else. He refused even to trouble his head about the problem set before him, the treachery of the Growler and the Masher, their connection with the grey-haired lady, the spying of which he himself was the object.
"Steady, Lupin," he said. "One only argues falsely in a fever, so hold your tongue. No inferences above all things. Nothing is more foolish than to infer one fact from another before finding a certain starting-point. That's where you get up a tree. Listen to your instinct, act according to your instinct, and as you are persuaded, outside all argument, outside all logic, one might say, that this business turns upon that confounded stopper, go for it boldly. Have at Daubrecq and his bit of crystal."
Lupin did not wait to arrive at these conclusions before settling his actions accordingly. At the moment when he was stating them in his mind, 3 days after the scene at the Vaudeville, he was sitting, dressed like a retired tradesman, in an old overcoat, with a muffler round his neck, on a bench in the Avenue Victor Hugo, at some distance from the Square Lamartine. Victor had his instructions to pass by that bench at the same hour every morning.
"Yes," he repeated to himself, "the crystal stopper, Everything turns on that. Once I get hold of it... Victoire arrived with her shopping basket on her arm. He at once noticed her extraordinary agitation and pallor. "What's the matter?" asked Lupin, walking beside his old nurse. She went into a big grocer's, which was crowded with people, and turning to him. "Here," she said, in a voice torn with excitement, "here's what you've been hunting for." And taking something from her basket, she gave it to him. Lupin stood astounded. In his hand lay the crystal stopper.
"Can it be true? Can it be true?"
he muttered, as though the ease of the solution had thrown him off his balance. But the fact remained, visible and palpable. He recognized by its shape, by its size, by the worn gilding of its facets, recognized beyond any possible doubt the crystal stopper which he had seen before. He even remarked a tiny, hardly noticeable little scratch on the stem which he remembered perfectly. However, while the thing presented all the same characteristics, it possessed no other that seemed out of the way. It was a crystal stopper, that was all. There was no really special mark to distinguish it from other stoppers. There was no sign upon it, no stamp, and being cut from a single piece, it contained no foreign object. What then? And Lupin received a quick insight into the depth of his mistake. What good could the possession of that crystal stopper do him so long as he was ignorant of its value? That bit of glass had no existence in itself. It counted only through the meaning that attached to it. Before taking it, the thing was to be certain. And how could he tell that, in taking it, in robbing Daubrecq of it, he was not committing an act of folly? It was a question which was impossible of solution, but which forced itself upon him with singular directness. "No blunders," he said to himself as he pocketed the stopper. "In this confounded business, blunders are fatal." He had not taken his eyes off Victoire. Accompanied by a shopman, she went from counter to counter, among the throng of customers. She next stood for some little while at the pay desk and passed in front of Lupin. He whispered her instructions. "Meet me behind the Lycée Janson." She joined him in an unfrequented street. "And suppose I'm followed," she said. "No," he declared. "I looked carefully. Listen to me. Where did you find the stopper?"
"In the drawer of the table by his bed."
"But we had felt there already."
"Yes, and I did so again this morning. I expect he put it there last night."
"And I expect he'll want to take it from there again," said Lupin.
"Very likely."
"And suppose he finds it gone?"
Victoire looked frightened.
"Answer me," said Lupin. "If he finds it gone, he'll accuse you of taking it, won't he?"
"Certainly."
"Then go and put it back, as fast as you can."
"Oh, dear, oh, dear," she moaned. "I hope he won't have had time to find out. Give it to me, quick."
"Here you are," said Lupin. He felt in the pocket of his overcoat.
"Well?" said Victoire, holding out her hand.
"Well," he said after a moment, "it's gone."
"What?"
"Yes, upon my word, it's gone. Somebody's taken it from me." He burst into a peal of laughter, a laughter which, this time, was free from all bitterness. Victoire flew out at him.
"Laugh away, putting me in such a predicament."
"How can I help laughing? You must confess that it's funny. It's no longer a tragedy that we're acting, but a fairy tale, as much a fairy tale as Puss in Boots or Jack and the Beanstalk. I must write it when I get a few weeks to myself. The Magic Stopper, or The Mishaps of Poor Arsène."
"Well, who has taken it from you?"
"What are you talking about? It has flown away, vanished from my pocket. Hey, presto, begone." He gave the old servant a gentle push and, in a more serious tone, "Go home, Victoire, and don't upset yourself. Of course someone saw you give me the stopper and took advantage of the crowd in the shop to pick my pocket of it. That only shows that we are watched more closely than I thought, and by adversaries of the first rank. But once more, be easy. Honest men always come by their own. Have you anything else to tell me?"
"Yes. Someone came yesterday evening while Monsieur Daubrecq was out. I saw lights reflected upon the trees in the garden."
"The portress's bedroom?"
"The portress's was up."
"Then it was some of those detective fellows. They are still hunting. I'll see you later, Victoire. You must let me in again."
"What? You want to..."
"What do I risk? Your room is on the third floor. Daubrecq suspects nothing."
"But the others..."
"The others? If it was to their interest to play me a trick, they'd have tried before now. I'm in their way, that's all. They're not afraid of me. So till later, Victoire, at 5 o'clock exactly." One further surprise awaited Lupin. In the evening, his old nurse told him that, Having opened the drawer of the bedside table from curiosity, she had found the crystal stopper there again. Lupin was no longer to be excited by these miraculous incidents. He simply said to himself, "So it's been brought back, and the person who brought it back and who enters this house by some unexplained means considered, as I did, that the stopper ought not to disappear. And yet Daubrecq, who knows that he is being spied upon to his very bedroom, has once more left the stopper in a drawer, as though he attached no importance to it at all. Now what is one to make of that?" Though Lupin did not make anything of it, nevertheless he could not escape certain arguments, certain associations of ideas that gave him the same vague foretaste of light which one receives on approaching the outlet of a tunnel. "It is inevitable, as the case stands," he thought, "that there must soon be an encounter between myself and the others. From that moment I shall be master of the situation." 5 days passed, during which Lupin did not glean the slightest particular. On the sixth day, Daubrecq received a visit in the small hours from a gentleman, Leblanc the deputy, who, like his colleagues, dragged himself at his feet in despair, and when all was done, handed him 20,000 francs. 2 more days, and then one night, posted on the landing of the second floor, Lupin heard the creaking of a door, the front door, as he perceived, which led from the hall into the garden. In the darkness he distinguished, or rather divined, the presence of 2 persons, who climbed the stairs and stopped on the first floor, outside Daubrecq's room. What were they doing there? It was not possible to enter the room, because Daubrecq bolted his door every night. Then what were they hoping? Manifestly, a handiwork of some kind was being performed, as Lupin discovered from the dull sounds of rubbing against the door. Then words, uttered almost beneath a whisper, reached him. "Is it all right?" "Yes, quite, but all the same, we'd better put it off till tomorrow, because..." Lupin did not hear the end of the sentence. The men were already groping their way downstairs. The hall door was closed, very gently, and then the gate. "It is curious, say what one likes," thought Lupin. "Here is a house in which Daubrecq carefully conceals his rascalities and is on his guard, not without good reason, against spies. And everybody walks in and out as in a booth at a fair. Victoire lets me in, the portress admits the emissaries of the police. That's well and good, but who is playing false in these people's favour? And are we to suppose that they are acting alone? But what fearlessness, and how well they know their way about!" In the afternoon, during Daubrecq's absence, he examined the door of the first-floor bedroom, and at the first glance he understood. One of the lower panels had been skilfully cut out, and was only held in place by invisible tacks. The people, therefore, who had done this work were the same who had acted at his 2 places, in the Rue Matignon and the Rue Chateaubriand. He also found that the work dated back to an earlier period, and that, as in his case, the opening had been prepared beforehand, in anticipation of favourable circumstances or of some immediate need. The day did not seem long to Lupin. Knowledge was at hand. Not only would he discover the manner in which his adversaries employed those little openings, which were apparently unemployable, since they did not allow a person to reach the upper bolts, but he would learn who the ingenious and energetic adversaries were with whom he repeatedly and inevitably found himself confronted. One incident annoyed him. In the evening, Daubrecq, who had complained of feeling tired at dinner, came home at 10 o'clock, and contrary to his usual custom, pushed the bolts of the hall door. In that case, how would the others be able to carry out their plan and go to Daubrecq's room? Lupin waited for an hour after Daubrecq put out his light. Then he went down to the deputy's study, opened one of the windows ajar, and returned to the third floor and fixed his rope ladder so that, in case of need, he could reach the study without passing through the house. Lastly, he resumed his post on the second-floor landing. He did not have to wait long. An hour earlier than on the previous night, someone tried to open the hall door. When the attempt failed, a few minutes of absolute silence followed, and Lupin was beginning to think that the men had abandoned the idea when he gave a sudden start. Someone had passed without the least sound to interrupt the silence. He would not have known it, so utterly were the thing's steps deadened by the stair-carpet, if the baluster rail, which he himself held in his hand, had not shaken slightly. Someone was coming upstairs. And as the ascent continued, Lupin became aware of the uncanny feeling that he heard nothing more than before. He knew, because of the rail, that a thing was coming, and he could count the number of steps climbed by noting each vibration of the rail. But no other indication gave him that dim sensation of presence which we feel in distinguishing movements which we do not see, in perceiving sounds which we do not hear. And yet a blacker darkness ought to have taken shape within the darkness, and something ought, at least, to modify the quality of the silence.
No, he might well have believed that there was no one there. And Lupin, in spite of himself and against the evidence of his reason, ended by believing it, for the rail no longer moved, and he thought that he might have been the sport of an illusion. And this lasted a long time. He hesitated, not knowing what to do, not knowing what to suppose. But an odd circumstance impressed him. A clock struck two. He recognized the chime of Daubrecq's clock, and the chime was that of a clock from which one is not separated by the obstacle of a door. Lupin slipped down the stairs and went to the door. It was closed, but there was a space on the left, at the bottom, a space left by the removal of the little panel. He listened. Daubrecq at that moment turned in his bed, and his breathing was resumed, evenly and a little stertorously. And Lupin plainly heard the sound of rumpling garments. Beyond a doubt, the thing was there, fumbling and feeling through the clothes which Daubrecq had laid beside his bed. Now, thought Lupin, we shall learn something. But how the deuce did the beggar get in? Has he managed to draw the bolts and open the door? But if so, why did he make the mistake of shutting it again? Not for a second, a curious anomaly in a man like Lupin, an anomaly to be explained only by the uncanny feeling which the whole adventure produced in him, not for a second did he suspect the very simple truth which was about to be revealed to him. Continuing his way down, he crouched on one of the bottom steps of the staircase, thus placing himself between the door of the bedroom and the hall door, on the road which Daubrecq's enemy must inevitably take in order to join his accomplices. He questioned the darkness with an unspeakable anguish. He was on the point of unmasking that enemy of Daubrecq's, who was also his own adversary. He would thwart his plans, and the booty captured from Daubrecq he would capture in his turn, while Daubrecq slept, and while the accomplices lurking behind the hall door, or outside the garden gate, vainly awaited their leader's return. And that return took place. Lupin knew it by the renewed vibration of the balusters, and once more, with every sense strained and every nerve on edge, he strove to discern the mysterious thing that was coming toward him. He suddenly realized it when only a few yards away. He himself, hidden in a still darker recess, could not be seen. And what he saw, in the very vaguest manner, was approaching stair by stair, with infinite precautions, holding on to each separate baluster. "Whom the devil have I to do with?" said Lupin to himself, while his heart thumped inside his chest. The catastrophe was hastened. A careless movement on Lupin's part was observed by the stranger, who stopped short. Lupin was afraid lest the other should turn back and take to flight. He sprang at the adversary and was stupefied at encountering nothing but space and knocking against the stairwell without seizing the form which he saw. But he at once rushed forward, crossed the best part of the hall, and caught up his antagonist just as he was reaching the door opening on the garden. There was a cry of fright, answered by other cries on the further side of the door. "Oh, hang it, what's this?" muttered Lupin, whose arms had closed, in the dark, round a little, tiny, trembling, whimpering thing. Suddenly understanding, he stood for a moment motionless and dismayed, at a loss what to do with his conquered prey. But the others were shouting and stamping outside the door. Thereupon, dreading lest Daubrecq should wake up, he slipped the little thing under his jacket, against his chest, stopped the crying with his handkerchief rolled into a ball, and hurried up the three flights of stairs. "Here," he said to Victoire, who woke with a start, "I've brought you the indomitable chief of our enemies, the Hercules of the gang. Have you a feeding bottle about you?" He put down in the easy-chair a child of 6 or 7 years of age, the tiniest little fellow in a grey jersey and a knitted woollen cap, whose pale and exquisitely pretty features were streaked with the tears that streamed from the terrified eyes. "Where did you pick that up?" asked Victoire aghast. "At the foot of the stairs, as it was coming out of Daubrecq's bedroom," replied Lupin, feeling the jersey in the hope that the child had brought a booty of some kind from that room. Victoire was stirred to pity. "Poor little dear! Look, he's trying not to cry. Oh, saints above, his hands are like ice! Don't be afraid, sonny, we shan't hurt you. The gentleman's all right." "Yes," said Lupin, "the gentleman's quite all right, but there's another very wicked gentleman who'll wake up if they go on making such a rumpus outside the hall door. Do you hear them, Victoire?" "Who is it?" "The satellites of our young Hercules, the indomitable leader's gang." "Well?" stammered Victoire, utterly unnerved. "Well, as I don't want to be caught in the trap, I shall start by clearing out. Are you coming, Hercules?" He rolled the child in a blanket, so that only its head remained outside, gagged its mouth as gently as possible, and made Victoire fasten it to his shoulders. "See, Hercules, we're having a game. You never thought you'd find gentlemen to play pick-a-back with you at 3 o'clock in the morning.
Come, whoosh, let's fly away. You don't get giddy, I hope." He stepped across the window ledge and set foot on one of the rungs of the ladder. He was in the garden in a minute. He had never ceased hearing, and now heard more plainly still, the blows that were being struck upon the front door. He was astounded that Daubrecq was not awakened by so violent a din. "If I don't put a stop to this, they'll spoil everything," he said to himself. He stood in an angle of the house, invisible in the darkness, and measured the distance between himself and the gate. The gate was open. To his right he saw the steps, on the top of which the people were flinging themselves about. To his left, the building occupied by the portress. The woman had come out of her lodge and was standing near the people, entreating them.
"Oh, do be quiet, do be quiet. He'll come."
"Capital," said Lupin. "The good woman is an accomplice of these as well. By jingo, what a pluralist." He rushed across to her, and taking her by the scruff of the neck, hissed, "Go and tell them I've got the child. They can come and fetch it at my place, Rue Chateaubriand." A little way off, in the avenue, stood a taxi which Lupin presumed to be engaged by the gang. Speaking authoritatively, as though he were one of the accomplices, he stepped into the cab and told the man to drive him home. "Well," he said to the child, "that wasn't much of a shake-up, was it? What do you say to going to bye-bye on the gentleman's bed?" As his servant, Achille, was asleep, Lupin made the little chap comfortable and stroked his hair for him. The child seemed numbed. His poor face was as though petrified into a stiff expression, made up, at one and the same time, of fear and the wish not to show fear, of the longing to scream and a pitiful effort not to scream. "Cry, my pet, cry," said Lupin. "It'll do you good to cry." The child did not cry, but the voice was so gentle and so kind that he relaxed his tense muscles, and now that his eyes were calmer and his mouth less contorted, Lupin, who was examining him closely, found something that he recognized, an undoubted resemblance. This again confirmed certain facts which he suspected, and which he had for some time been linking in his mind. Indeed, unless he was mistaken, the position was becoming very different, and he would soon assume the direction of events. After that... A ring at the bell, followed at once by two others, sharp ones. "Hello," said Lupin to the child. "Here's Mummy come to fetch you. Don't move." He ran and opened the door. A woman entered wildly. "My son!" she cried. "My son, where is he?" "In my room," said Lupin. Without asking more, thus proving that she knew the way, she rushed to the bedroom. "As I thought," muttered Lupin. "The youngish woman with the grey hair, Daubrecq's friend and enemy." He walked to the window and looked through the curtains. Two men were striding up and down the opposite pavement, the Growler and the Masher. "And they're not even hiding themselves," he said to himself. "That's a good sign. They consider that they can't do without me any longer, and that they've got to obey the governor. There remains the pretty lady with the grey hair. That will be more difficult. It's you and I now, Mummy." He found the mother and the boy clasped in each other's arms, and the mother, in a great state of alarm, her eyes moist with tears, was saying, "You're not hurt? You're sure? Oh, how frightened you must have been, my poor little Jacques." "A fine little fellow," said Lupin. She did not reply. She was feeling the child's jersey, as Lupin had done, no doubt to see if he had succeeded in his nocturnal mission, and she questioned him in a whisper. "No, Mummy," said the child, "no, really." She kissed him fondly and petted him, until, in a little while, the child, worn out with fatigue and excitement, fell asleep. She remained leaning over him for a long time. She herself seemed very much worn out and in need of rest. Lupin did not disturb her contemplation. He looked at her anxiously, with an attention which she did not perceive, and he noticed the wider rings round her eyes and the deeper marks of wrinkles. Yet he considered her handsomer than he had thought, with that touching beauty which habitual suffering gives to certain faces that are more human, more sensitive than others. She wore so sad an expression that, in a burst of instinctive sympathy, he went up to her and said, "I do not know what your plans are, but, whatever they may be, you stand in need of help. You cannot succeed alone." "I am not alone." "The two men outside? I know them. They are no good. I beseech you, make use of me. You remember the other evening at the theatre, in the private box? You were on the point of speaking. Do not hesitate today." She turned her eyes on him, looked at him long and fixedly, and as though unable to escape that opposing will, she said, "What do you know exactly? What do you know about me?" "There are many things that I do not know. I do not know your name, but I know..." She interrupted him with a gesture,
and resolutely, in her turn, dominating the man who was compelling her to speak. "It doesn't matter," she exclaimed. "What you know, after all, is not much, and is of no importance. But what are your plans? You offer me your help. With what view? For what work? You have flung yourself headlong into this business. I've been unable to undertake anything without meeting you on my path. You must be contemplating some aim. What aim?"
"What aim? Upon my word, it seems to me that my conduct..."
"No, no," she said emphatically, "no phrases. What you and I want is certainties, and to achieve them, absolute frankness. I will set you the example. Monsieur Daubrecq possesses a thing of unparalleled value, not in itself, but for what it represents. That thing you know. You have twice held it in your hands. I have twice taken it from you. Well, I am entitled to believe that, when you tried to obtain possession of it, you meant to use the power which you attribute to it, and to use it to your own advantage."
"What makes you say that?"
"Yes, you meant to use it to forward your schemes, in the interest of your own affairs, in accordance with your habits as a..."
"As a burglar and a swindler," said Lupin, completing the sentence for her.
She did not protest. He tried to read her secret thoughts in the depths of her eyes. What did she want with him? What was she afraid of? If she mistrusted him, had he not also reasons to mistrust that woman who had twice taken the crystal stopper from him to restore it to Daubrecq? Mortal enemy of Daubrecq's though she were, up to what point did she remain subject to that man's will? By surrendering himself to her, did he not risk surrendering himself to Daubrecq? And yet he had never looked upon graver eyes, nor a more honest face. Without further hesitation, he stated, "My object is simple enough. It is the release of my friends Gilbert and Vaucheray."
"Is that true? Is that true?" she exclaimed, quivering all over and questioning him with an anxious glance.
"If you knew me..."
"I do know you. I know who you are. For months I have taken part in your life, without your suspecting it. And yet, for certain reasons, I still doubt."
He said in a more decisive tone,
"You do not know me. If you knew me, you would know that there can be no peace for me before my two companions have escaped the awful fate that awaits them."
She rushed at him, took him by the shoulders, and, positively distraught, said,
"What? What did you say? The awful fate? Then you believe... you believe..."
"I really believe," said Lupin, who felt how greatly this threat upset her, "I really believe that if I am not in time, Gilbert and Vaucheray are done for."
"Be quiet, be quiet," she cried, clutching him fiercely. "Be quiet, you mustn't say that. There is no reason. It's just you who suppose..."
"It's not only I, it's Gilbert as well."
"What? Gilbert? How do you know?"
"From himself."
"From him?"
"Yes, from Gilbert, who has no hope left but in me. From Gilbert, who knows that only one man in the world can save him, and who a few days ago sent me a despairing appeal from prison. Here is his letter." She snatched the paper greedily and read in stammering accents,
"Help, Governor. I am afraid. I am afraid."
She dropped the letter. Her hands fluttered in space. It was as though her staring eyes beheld the sinister vision which had already so often terrified Lupin. She gave a scream of horror, tried to rise, and fainted.
Chapter 5. The 27. The child was sleeping peacefully on the bed. The mother did not move from the sofa on which Lupin had laid her, but her easier breathing and the blood which was now returning to her face announced her impending recovery from her swoon. He observed that she wore a wedding ring. Seeing a locket hanging from her bodice, he stooped and, turning it, found a miniature photograph representing a man of about 40, and a lad, a stripling rather, in a schoolboy's uniform. He studied the fresh, young face set in curly hair. "It's as I thought," he said. "Ah, poor woman." The hand which he took between his grew warmer by degrees. The eyes opened, then closed again. She murmured,
"Jacques...
do not distress yourself. It's all right. He's asleep." She recovered consciousness entirely. But as she did not speak, Lupin put questions to her, to make her feel a gradual need of unbosoming herself. And he said, pointing to the locket,
"The schoolboy is Gilbert, isn't he?"
"Yes," she said.
"And Gilbert is your son?"
She gave a shiver and whispered,
"Yes, Gilbert is my son, my eldest son."
So she was the mother of Gilbert the prisoner at the Santé, relentlessly pursued by the authorities and now awaiting his trial for murder. Lupin continued,
"And the other portrait?"
"My husband."
"Your husband?"
"Yes, he died 3 years ago."
She was now sitting up. Life quivered in her veins once more, together with the horror of living and the horror of all the ghastly things that threatened her. Lupin went on to ask,
"What was your husband's name?"
She hesitated a moment and answered,
"Mergy."
He exclaimed,
"Victorien Mergy, the deputy?"
"Yes." There was a long pause. Lupin remembered the incident and the stir which it had caused. 3 years ago, Mergy, the deputy, had blown out his brains in the lobby of the chamber, without leaving a word of explanation behind him, and no one had ever discovered the slightest reason for that suicide.
"Do you know the reason?" asked Lupin, completing his thought aloud.
"Yes, I know it."
"Gilbert, perhaps?"
"No, Gilbert had disappeared for some years, turned out of doors and cursed by my husband. It was a very great sorrow, but there was another motive."
"What was that?" asked Lupin.
But it was not necessary for Lupin to put further questions. Madame Mergy could keep silent no longer, and slowly at first, with all the anguish of that past which had to be called up, she told her story. 25 years ago, when my name was Clarisse d'Arcel and my parents living, I knew 3 young men at Nice. Their names will at once give you an insight into the present tragedy. They were Alexis Daubrecq, Victorien Mergy, and Louis Praville. The three were old acquaintances, had gone to college in the same year, and served in the same regiment. Praville, at that time, was in love with a singer at the opera house at Nice. The two others, Mergy and Daubrecq, were in love with me. I shall be brief as regards all this, and for the rest, as regards the whole story, for the facts tell their own tale. I fell in love with Victorien Mergy from the first. Perhaps I was wrong not to declare myself at once, but true love is always timid, hesitating, and shy, and I did not announce my choice until I felt quite certain and quite free. Unfortunately, that period of waiting, so delightful for those who cherish a secret passion, had permitted Daubrecq to hope. His anger was something horrible." Clarisse Mergy stopped for a few seconds and resumed, in a stifled voice,
"I shall never forget it. The three of us were in the drawing-room. Oh, I can hear even now the terrible words of threat and hatred which he uttered. Victorien was absolutely astounded. He had never seen his friend like this, with that repugnant face, that bestial expression. Yes, the expression of a wild beast. Daubrecq ground his teeth. He stamped his feet, his bloodshot eyes. He did not wear spectacles in those days. Rolled in their sockets. And he kept on saying, 'I shall be revenged. I shall be revenged. Oh, you don't know what I am capable of. I shall wait 10 years, 20 years, if necessary. But it will come like a thunderbolt. Ah, you don't know. To be revenged, to do harm, for harm's sake. What joy! I was born to do harm, and you will both beseech my mercy on your knees. On your knees, yes! On your knees, yes! On your knees!' At that moment my father entered the room, and with his assistants and the footman's, Victorien Mergy flung the loathsome creature out of doors. 6 weeks later I married Victorien."
"And Daubrecq?" asked Lupin, interrupting her.
"Did he not try?"
"No, but on our wedding day, Louis Praville, who acted as my husband's best man, in defiance of Daubrecq's opposition, went home to find the girl he loved, the opera singer, dead, strangled."
"What?" said Lupin with a start.
"Had Daubrecq—"
It was known that Daubrecq had been persecuting her with his attentions for some days, but nothing more was known. It was impossible to discover who had gone in or out during Praville's absence. There was not a trace found of any kind. Nothing, absolutely nothing.
But Praville?
There was no doubt of the truth in Praville's mind or ours. Daubrecq had tried to run away with the girl, perhaps tried to force her, to hustle her, and, in the course of the struggle, maddened, losing his head, caught her by the throat and killed her, perhaps without knowing what he was doing. But there was no evidence of all this, and Daubrecq was not even molested.
And what became of him next?
For some years we heard nothing of him. We knew only that he had lost all his money gambling, and that he was travelling in America. And in spite of myself, I forgot his anger and his threats, and was only too ready to believe that he had ceased to love me, and no longer harboured his schemes of revenge. Besides, I was so happy that I did not care to think of anything but my happiness, my love, my husband's political career, the health of my son Antoine."
"Antoine?"
"Yes, Antoine is Gilbert's real name. The unhappy boy has at least succeeded in concealing his identity. Lupin asked with some hesitation, "At what period did Gilbert begin?" "I cannot tell you exactly. Gilbert, I prefer to call him that and not to pronounce his real name. Gilbert, as a child, was what he is today, lovable, liked by everybody, charming, but lazy and unruly. When he was 15, we put him to a boarding school in one of the suburbs, with the deliberate object of not having him too much at home. After 2 years' time, he was expelled from school and sent back to us."
"Why?"
"Because of his conduct. The masters had discovered that he used to slip out at night, and also that he would disappear for weeks at a time, while pretending to be at home with us."
"What used he to do?"
"Amuse himself backing horses, spending his time in cafes and public dancing rooms."
"Then he had money?"
"Yes."
"Who gave it him?"
"His evil genius, the man who secretly, unknown to his parents, enticed him away from school, the man who led him astray, who corrupted him, who took him from us, who taught him to lie, to waste his substance, and to steal."
"Daubrecq?"
"Daubrecq." Clarisse Mergy put her hands together to hide the blushes on her forehead. She continued in her tired voice, "Daubrecq had taken his revenge. On the day after my husband turned our unhappy child out of the house, Daubrecq sent us a most cynical letter in which he revealed the odious part which he had played and the machinations by which he had succeeded in depraving our son. And he went on to say, the reformatory, one of these days, later on the assize court, and then, let us hope and trust, the scaffold." Lupin exclaimed,
"What? Did Daubrecq plot the present business?"
"No, no, that is only an accident. The hateful prophecy was just a wish which he expressed. But oh, how it terrified me! I was ailing at the time. My other son, my little Jacques, had just been born, and every day we heard some fresh misdeed of Gilbert's, forgeries, swindles, so much so that we spread the news in our immediate surroundings of his departure for abroad, followed by his death. Life was a misery, and it became still more so when the political storm burst in which my husband was to meet his death."
"What do you mean?"
"A word will be enough. My husband's name was on the list of the 27.
"Ah."
The veil was suddenly lifted from Lupin's eyes, and he saw, as in a flash of lightning, a whole legion of things which, until then, had been hidden in the darkness. Clarisse Mergy continued in a firmer voice, "Yes, his name was on it, but by mistake, by a piece of incredible ill luck of which he was the victim. It is true that Victorien Mergy was a member of the committee appointed to consider the question of the Two Seas Canal. It is true that he voted with the members who were in favour of the company's scheme. He was even paid. Yes, I tell you so plainly, and I will mention the sum. He was paid 15,000 francs. But he was paid on behalf of another, of one of his political friends, a man in whom he had absolute confidence and of whom he was the blind, unconscious tool. He thought he was showing his friend a kindness, and it proved his own undoing. It was not until the day after the suicide of the chairman of the company and the disappearance of the secretary, the day on which the affair of the canal was published in the papers, with its whole series of swindles and abominations, that my husband knew that a number of his fellow members had been bribed and learned that the mysterious list, of which people suddenly began to speak, mentioned his name with theirs and with the names of other deputies, leaders of parties and influential politicians. Oh, what awful days those were! Would the list be published? Would his name come out? The torture of it! You remember the mad excitement in the chamber, the atmosphere of terror and denunciation that prevailed. Who owned the list? Nobody could say. It was known to be in existence, and that was all. Two names were sacrificed to public odium. Two men were swept away by the storm, and it remained unknown where the denunciation came from and in whose hands the incriminating documents were."
"Daubrecq," suggested Lupin.
"No, no," cried Madame Mergy. "Daubrecq was nothing at that time. He had not yet appeared upon the scene. No, don't you remember, the truth came out suddenly through the very man who was keeping it back. Germinaud, the ex-minister of justice, a cousin of the chairman of the canal company. As he lay dying of consumption, he wrote from his sickbed to the prefect of police, bequeathing him that list of names, which, he said, would be found, after his death, in an iron chest in the corner of his room. The house was surrounded by police, and the prefect took up his quarters by the sick man's bedside. Germinaud died. The chest was opened and found to be empty."
"Daubrecq this time," Lupin declared.
"Yes, Daubrecq," said Madame Mergy, whose excitement was momentarily increasing.
Alexis Daubrecq, who for 6 months, disguised beyond recognition, had acted as Germineux's secretary. It does not matter how he discovered that Germineux was the possessor of the paper in question. The fact remains that he broke open the chest on the night before the death. So much was proved at the inquiry, and Daubrecq's identity was established. But he was not arrested. What would have been the use? They knew well enough that he must have deposited the list in a place of safety. His arrest would have involved a scandal, the reopening of the whole case. So they made terms. Lupin laughed.
That's funny, making terms with Daubrecq.
Yes, very funny, said Madame Mergy, bitterly. During this time he acted, and without delay, shamelessly, making straight for the goal. A week after the theft, he went to the Chamber of Deputies, asked for my husband, and bluntly demanded 30,000 francs of him, to be paid within 24 hours. If not, he threatened him with exposure and disgrace. My husband knew the man he was dealing with, knew him to be implacable and filled with relentless hatred. He lost his head and shot himself.
How absurd, Lupin could not help saying.
How absurd! Daubrecq possesses a list of 27 names. To give up any one of those names, he is obliged, if he would have his accusation believed, to publish the list itself, that is to say, to part with the document, or at least a photograph of it. Well, in so doing, he creates a scandal, it is true, but he deprives himself at the same time of all further means of levying blackmail.
Yes and no, she said.
How do you know?
Through Daubrecq himself. The villain came to see me and cynically told me of his interview with my husband and the words that had passed between them.
Well, there is more than that list, more than that famous bit of paper on which the secretary put down the names and the amounts paid and to which, you will remember, the chairman of the company, before dying, affixed his signature in letters of blood. There is more than that. There are certain less positive proofs which the people interested do not know of. The correspondence between the chairman and the secretary, between the chairman and his counsel, and so on. Of course, the list scribbled on the bit of paper is the only evidence that counts. It is the one incontestable proof which it would be no good copying or even photographing, for its genuineness can be tested most absolutely. But all the same, the other proofs are dangerous. They have already been enough to do away with two deputies. And Daubrecq is marvelously clever at turning this fact to account. He selects his victim, frightens him out of his senses, points out to him the inevitable scandal, and the victim pays the required sum. Or else he kills himself, as my husband did. Do you understand now?
Yes, said Lupin.
And in the silence that followed, he drew a mental picture of Daubrecq's life. He saw him the owner of that list, using his power, gradually emerging from the shadow, lavishly squandering the money which he extorted from his victims, securing his election as a district councillor and deputy, holding sway by dint of threats and terror, unpunished, invulnerable, unattackable, feared by the government, which would rather submit to his orders than declare war upon him, respected by the judicial authorities. So powerful, in a word, that Prasville had been appointed secretary-general of police, over the heads of all who had prior claims, for the sole reason that he hated Daubrecq with a personal hatred.
"And you saw him again?" he asked.
"I saw him again. I had to. My husband was dead, but his honour remained untouched. Nobody suspected the truth. In order at least to defend the name which he left me, I accepted my first interview with Daubrecq."
"Your first, yes, for there had been others."
"Many others," she said in a strained voice. "Yes, many others. At the theatre, or in the evening at Enghien, or else in Paris, at night. For I was ashamed to meet that man, and I did not want people to know it. But it was necessary. A duty more imperative than any other commanded it, the duty of avenging my husband." She bent over Lupin, and eagerly, "Yes, revenge has been the motive of my conduct and the sole preoccupation of my life. To avenge my husband, to avenge my ruined son, to avenge myself for all the harm that he has done me. I had no other dream, no other object in life. That is what I wanted, to see that man crushed, reduced to poverty, to tears, as though he still knew how to cry, sobbing in the throes of despair."
"You wanted his death," said Lupin, remembering the scene between them in Daubrecq's study.
"No, not his death. I have often thought of it. I have even raised my arm to strike him. But what would have been the good? He must have taken his precautions. The paper would remain. And then there is no revenge in killing a man. My hatred went further than that. It demanded his ruin, his downfall. And to achieve that, there was but one way, to cut his claws. Daubrecq, deprived of the document that gives him his immense power, ceases to exist. It means immediate bankruptcy and disaster, under the most wretched conditions. That is what I have sought.
But Daubrecq must have been aware of your intentions.
Certainly, and I assure you, those were strange meetings of ours. I watching him closely, trying to guess his secret behind his actions and his words, and he,
said Lupin, finishing Clarisse's thought, lying in wait for the prey which he desires, for the woman whom he has never ceased to love, whom he loves, and whom he covets with all his might and with all his furious passion.
She lowered her head and said simply, "Yes."
A strange duel indeed was that which brought face to face those two beings separated by so many implacable things. How unbridled must Daubrecq's passion be for him to risk that perpetual threat of death and to introduce to the privacy of his house this woman whose life he had shattered. But also how absolutely safe he must feel himself.
"And your search ended how?" asked Lupin.
"My search," he replied, "long remained without fruit. You know the methods of investigation which you have followed, and which the police have followed on their side. Well, I myself employed them, years before either of you did, and in vain. I was beginning to despair. Then one day, when I had gone to see Daubrecq in his villa at Enghien, I picked up under his writing-table a letter which he had begun to write, crumpled up and thrown into the waste-paper basket. It consisted of a few lines in bad English, and I was able to read this: "Empty the crystal within, so as to leave a void which it is impossible to suspect." Perhaps I should not have attached to the sentence all the importance which it deserved if Daubrecq, who was out in the garden, had not come running in and begun to turn out the waste-paper basket with an eagerness which was very significant. He gave me a suspicious look. "There was a letter there," he said. I pretended not to understand. He did not insist, but his agitation did not escape me. And I continued my quest in this direction. A month later I discovered, among the ashes in the drawing-room fireplace, the torn half of an English invoice. I gathered that a Stourbridge glassblower, of the name of John Howard, had supplied Daubrecq with a crystal bottle made after a model. The word crystal struck me at once. I went to Stourbridge, got round the foreman of the glassworks, and learned that the stopper of this bottle had been hollowed out inside, in accordance with the instruction in the order, so as to leave a cavity, the existence of which would escape observation.
Lupin nodded his head.
"The thing tallies beyond a doubt. Nevertheless, it did not seem to me that, even under the gilt layer, and then the hiding-place would be very tiny."
"Tiny, but large enough," she said. "On my return from England, I went to the police office to see Prasville, whose friendship for me had remained unchanged. I did not hesitate to tell him, first, the reasons which had driven my husband to suicide, and secondly, the object of revenge which I was pursuing. When I informed him of my discoveries, he jumped for joy, and I felt that his hatred for Daubrecq was as strong as ever. I learned from him that the list was written on a slip of exceedingly thin foreign post-paper, which, when rolled up into a sort of pellet, would easily fit into an exceedingly limited space. Neither he nor I had the least hesitation. We knew the hiding-place. We agreed to act independently of each other, while continuing to correspond in secret. I put him in touch with Clémence, the portress in the Square Lamartine, who is entirely devoted to me."
"But less so to Prasville," said Lupin, "for I can prove that she betrays him."
"Now, perhaps, but not at the start, and the police searches were numerous. It was at that time, 10 months ago, that Gilbert came into my life again. A mother never loses her love for her son, whatever he may do, whatever he may have done. And then Gilbert has such a way with him. Well, you know him. He cried, kissed my little Jacques, his brother, and I forgave him." She stopped, and weary-voiced, with her eyes fixed on the floor, continued, "Would to heaven that I had not forgiven him! Oh, if that hour could but return, how readily I should find the horrible courage to turn him away! My poor child! It was I who ruined him! And pensively, I should have had that or any sort of courage if he had been as I pictured him to myself, and as he himself told me he had long been, bearing the marks of vice and dissipation, coarse, deteriorated. But though he was utterly changed in appearance, so much so that I could hardly recognize him, there was, from the point of view of, how shall I put it, from the moral point of view, an undoubted improvement. You had helped him, lifted him, and though his mode of life was hateful to me, nevertheless he retained a certain self-respect, a sort of underlying decency that showed itself on the surface once more. He was gay, careless, happy, and he used to talk of you with such affection." She picked her words, betraying her embarrassment,
not daring, in Lupin's presence, to condemn the line of life which Gilbert had selected, and yet unable to speak in favour of it.
"What happened next?" asked Lupin.
"I saw him very often. He would come to me by stealth, or else I went to him, and we would go for walks in the country. In this way I was gradually induced to tell him our story, of his father's suicide.